that song he was reading, that was actually talking about the Lord's Vineyard, talking about Israel. And you notice what he said in the song, that the Lord removed the heads from around us and all the other heathen, they came and they plucking off us. In other words, you know, that's what happened with Israel, because Israel is the Lord's vineyard. You know, and what was supposed to come forth from this vineyard was number righteous. You know, so the Lord, you know, throughout the scriptures, even when you go into Songs of Solomon, you see that the Lord is talking about how he had love for Israel, how much he loved the children of Israel, regardless of how bad we may seem to the world, that he still had love for us. But at the end of the day, you know, we are in a bad predicament right now, and the nations are taking advantage of it. Well, you know, it's like a catch-22. You really can't blame the nations for our predicament, because we disobeyed the Lord. So that was a great Psalms, especially to open up the class, because it kind of go hand in hand with what the class is about today. As you can see from the title of the class, it's called The Great Tribulation, The Hour of Temptation, and Jacob's Trouble. It's all bad. You know how like we like to say it's all good? No, it ain't good. Ain't nothing good about this. It's all bad. You ain't gonna find no glorious scenario about either one of these. They all the same. The Great Tribulation is the same as the Hour of Temptation. The Hour of Temptation is the same as Jacob's Trouble. And even when you look at, you know, the word Jacob, that's making reference to Jacob, the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. And Jacob is dead at this point. You know, he's not even alive, but his seed, his sons, are still alive today. You know, and right now, to the world, they're considered outcasts. But, you know, they are the 12 tribes of Israel, or the 12 tribes of Jacob. Jacob got his name changed to Israel, which we're going to look at today. You know, so another name for this time is called Jacob's Trouble. And it's mainly speaking of a time that's going to come on the world, come on the earth, where they're going to have full reign to take down these people. You know, as we see a lot of different events happening in the world today, you know, it's kind of like a preparation for us to get ready for what's coming. You know, right now we just at the tip of the iceberg, you know. So when I was putting the class together today, I mean, you know, throughout this week studying it, it's just so much pertaining to this. It's a lot that's going on in this, and we, you know, sometimes we like to talk about, well, not necessarily like to talk about, we just talk about a lot of things that's going to happen during the time of the Great Tribulation, but we really don't hound in on the point as far as like where you need to be at or how you're going to escape. And we're going to look at that today, you know, to show you that the Lord is the same as he was back during the time of Lot, back during the time of Noah. You know, he didn't take nobody off to heaven or anything like that. All the action went down on this earth, just like the action getting ready to go down on the earth, coming up here real soon. But, you know, the Lord ain't going to come in the middle of the tribulation and take us off to heaven so we can avoid this time. You know, the Lord got a secret place, got a place to hide the church, and you just got to be willing to get there. You know, just like the children of Israel had to have faith during the time when the Lord was getting ready to bring them out of Egypt, they had to have faith and take the blood of that lamb and put it on their doorposts. You know, and once they exercised that faith, when that death angel came through there, you know, the Lord passed over that house when he saw the blood. You know, so that's all an act of faith. Just like it's going to be an act of faith when it come down to this bad time with Jacob's trouble or the hour of temptation, the great tribulation, when we get down to this time, it's going to be an act of faith. You know, you leaving what it is you have. You know, you're going to have to turn your back on your family members. You know, you're going to have to turn your back on your job. You know, you're going to have to, I mean, your faith is actually going to be tested to the point we going out into the middle of nowhere. And you probably going to wonder how we're going to eat, how we're going to have clothes. Lord going to take care of all that. You know, but the simple fact is your faith going to have to be built up to the point, you know, for you to make that decision. You know, and if you can just, you look around today, you see how things kind of, you know, starting to unfold a little bit. Well, not really a little bit, a lot. Things are starting to pick up. And it's really hard to, you know, kind of even keep up with the events that's going on. You know, I like to consider myself somebody that always try to stay on top of the current events so I don't get caught off guard. But so much stuff is happening right now, I'm almost to the point I can't even, I don't even care. You know, you know, I just, I'm at the point now, I just try to watch Rome, you know, see what's happening in Rome. But I used to be the type, I used to watch America, I used to watch what's going on with martial law and the vaccines, and, you know, I just pay attention to all that type of stuff. But it's so much happening, I can't keep up with that. Only thing I keep up with is trying to make sure I'm raising my family right, keeping my house in the Word of God, you know, walking according to the law, statutes, and commandments, and keeping my eye on Rome. You know, ultimately right now, my concern is what they're doing in Palestine and what they're going to do. You know, Netanyahu and Mahmoud Abbas, what type of agreement they're going to come up with. Because once they hit that agreement, sisters and brothers, it's a wrap. Once Palestine becomes a state, at that point, and that's when Israel is going to have the right to go in there and build that temple. When they build that temple, that's when it's going to start. That's going to get us ready for the Great Tribulation. See, they want the temple to be built, but they don't understand that when they build that temple, this is going to actually get ready to start the attack on us as a nation of people. See, people don't understand that. The world talk about the Great Tribulation and how the Lord coming back. Man, it's going to be a beatdown on the Negro before the Lord returns. That's why it's called Jacob's Trouble. We ain't talking about Hamites. I ain't talking about Africa. I'm talking about the so-called Negro that's scattered throughout this world. The Lord going to allow Satan to be released, you know, to come after this people. But he said he's going to be their redeemer. He's going to be their savior. But that's ultimately what this Great Tribulation about. You know, and this is what we got to get prepared for. And it's not going to just hit us by ourselves. You're going to have other people that's going to be a part of this church, a part of keeping the commandments and doing what the Lord said. They're going to have to be beheaded for the witness of Jesus also. But as a body, you know, Israel is going to get ready to catch it. And this is why you're starting to see the world, you know, looking at what's happening. Every week we fight. I mean, did y'all forget about what happened in South Carolina? You probably did, because we got the Baltimore incident taking place. You know what I'm saying? And then this Tuesday just passed, another guy, 20 years old, got hit, you know, shot 10 times by the Fed inside his father's house. But, you know, it's coming so quick, you just look at it and keep on moving. But this is the time that we're getting ready to come into. Before we actually jump into the Great Tribulation, trouble going to start picking up. And that's what's starting to happen. So we're going to get into the Word. We're going to look at this today. And the goal is to make sure we get understanding on this stuff. And we're not going to really look too much at, you know, the Gentile dynasty and stuff like that. We're going to look a little bit at it, but mainly we want to see, you know, these different events. You know, why they call the Great Tribulation, why is it called the Hour of Temptation, why is it called Jacob's Trouble? You know, who is the abomination, the desolation? The Bible tell you he's going to stand in the holy place. We need to find out where this holy place is. Because this way, you know, when we leave today, you will know what you need to be looking for. You will know what it is you need to pay attention to. All right, so we're going to open this up in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, and we're going to pick it up at verse 4. You know, once you go into the chapter here, what's going on is, you know, they come to Jesus to show Jesus the builders of the temple. You know, they had authority to go back and rebuild the temple. So once Jesus gets there, you know, they show him the buildings of the temple. They're kind of excited about it. And the Lord mainly going to let them know that this temple is going to be destroyed. So they proceed to ask the Lord, well, when shall these things be? What should be the sign of your coming and the end of the world? So go ahead and pick it up at verse 4. Let's see what the Lord says.
And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you.
So the first thing the Lord said, you know, concerning, because just so you know, when he says, you know, verse 2, he lets you know, there should not be left with one stone upon another, that should not be thrown down. So we, you know, that's 7 AD. That took place with Jerusalem in 7 AD when Israel went in, you know, started going off into captivity. All right, so that already took place. But they also asked him something else. They said, what shall be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? So the first thing the Lord responded was, he said, take heed that no man deceive you. You know, hey, Satan, watch out for the murderer. Watch out for the backbiter, the people that's going to lie on you and talk about you. He said, watch out for the deceived. But see, if you get deceived in this stuff, this is what's going to catch you up. And you got to pay attention, especially now, you know, because there's a lot of deception that's going on. You know, one of the biggest deceptions we got going on right now pertaining to this particular subject is that the Lord going to take you off to heaven. You know, during this time, you're going to be able to escape this. And you're going to sit in heaven with the Lord and you're going to watch the Great Tribulation. And then once it's over, you're coming back. That's a lie. But it told you, take heed that no man deceive you. Why? Verse 5.
For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ.
Keep reading, brother.
And shall deceive
many. Put your finger right there. You need a bigger Bible? Yes, you do. Let me give you a bigger Bible. Yeah, I got one right here.
Okay.
I don't want you breaking up like this. Let that spirit flow. we're gonna make sure you straight, man. Don't be nervous. You good? There you go. Should be a little bit bigger, bro. Alright, go and read that verse again. Well, you're five, I think.
Yeah. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ.
Uh-huh, so he said, many go come in my name, saying, I am Christ. You know, whether it be, you know, y'all remember May 11, 2011, when they was like, Jesus was coming back. They had, it was in different cities around the world, but I know they did in Atlanta also. They went down to, was it Centennial Park? Yeah. Where they met up at, and they thought, oh, Jesus was going to come back at 6 o'clock. You know, even back, and they was doing this throughout all the cities. I got a friend of mine in Jacksonville, he's on the fire department, and he said, man, we had a guy that worked with us, man, sold all this stuff, gave up his retirement and everything, and donated all this money to that preacher, the one who had people saying that the Lord gonna come back at 6. And, you know, so it was going on everywhere. It was, most of the world was deceived by that anyway. But the Lord warned you about that. You know, he's telling you, what he say? Many gonna come in my name saying I'm Christ and shall deceive many. So you're gonna have also people coming, not only, you know, saying they Jesus, because you got this guy in Australia to say he Jesus. You know, he white, so we know that's a lie. You know, so he say he Jesus, and then he got his wife, he say she married. You know, but the Lord tell you about this type of stuff. He just look it up. So he tell you about it. So he say, many gonna come in my name saying I'm Christ and shall deceive many. So that's gonna be the order of the day, deception. They're gonna deceive many. So this is what Jesus jumped off with. He ain't jumping off with nothing else. He said, watch out, because many gonna be deceived. And the ones that's gonna come in his name, they're gonna be coming as your preachers. You know, they're going to be coming as the one that stand behind a pulpit that's supposed to have understanding. But what you got, let me tell you to take heed that no man deceive you. Now keep in mind, we're looking, you know, we're talking about the coming of the Lord, the second coming and the end of the world, and the Lord is giving you signs. So he's giving you a sign that you need to be mindful of, because, you know, once this deception start running rapid, a lot of people going to get caught up in it. That's why I say many are going to be deceived. But keep reading. Skip down to verse 14.
And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all of the world for a witness unto all nations.
Go ahead.
And then shall the end come.
That's right. So we're not talking about, you know, the gospel as far as what we've been getting, you know, coming up in the Sunday church, you know, the Christmas, the Easter, and all that type of stuff. That's not the gospel system, brother. Just let me make something plain to you. That then went throughout the whole world. You know, Christianity, you know, that false doctrine, that's all over the world. That's why December 25th, they celebrate Christmas here. And then in January 6th, they celebrate Christmas in Africa. Because it's been, that false doctrine is already throughout the whole world. But the gospel, we're talking about the gospel of the kingdom, the gospel of the coming of God. That's what we're talking about. This kingdom that's getting ready to come to this earth. And this is what's being preached now. By way of myself, like we got our teacher up in Ohio today, you know what I'm saying? Then we got all other camps around the world we preaching about the coming of the Lord. Because see, that's what God do. Before the Lord send destruction on this earth, he going to send out a warning. Just like he used Noah back in the day, you know, just like he had Lot back in the day, you know, he was vexed with the filthy conversation that was going on during that time. You know, but the Lord always have a way to send out a warning before he bring destruction. Well, that's what's coming right now. So if you notice what he say, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. So ain't nobody gonna be able to say, well, I ain't get a chance to find out about it. You know, some people dead, or some people died. The Lord gonna judge you based on what it is, you know. But now as we get toward the end of this generation, you know, this gospel is gonna be used for a witness against the nation system. You know, you got your smartphones, you got your computers, you got all different forms of technology, you know, where you can find out what's going on. It's just whether you're going to be lazy or not, you know, to indulge yourself in finding out. So he say, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And what's going to happen after?
When ye therefore
shall... Then shall the end come. So once this gospel get throughout the whole world, then the end going to come. So now you know we're getting closer and closer to the end. See, this, you know, really the truth didn't jump out here until this internet hit. See, once this internet hit, then now you can go in there and you can find out all type of lies and deception that's taking place. So I think around 92, 93, when they really started picking up as we got later into the, you know, 97, 98, 2000, you know, people start catching on to it. And as we start catching on to it, then we start finding out that we've been lied to. Then we start finding the different preachers and teachers around the world that's bringing forth the gospel. Now the cat is out the bag. So by the cat being out the bag, what's Satan going to do? Satan got to turn it up awesome. And that's what you're starting to see happen because why? We're getting closer to the end of the world now. Matter of fact, we're at the door. So he say, then shall the end come. Verse 15, go ahead.
When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place.
Go ahead.
Whoso readeth, let him understand.
All right, so when you see the abomination of desolation, stand in the holy place. We got to look at this, man. We got to find out abomination, you know, all filthy type of wickedness coming from this guy. But we're going to see why he called the abomination of desolation or the man of destruction. Let's go on to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to look at him a little further. See, the world following him right now. And you know, you may say, well, I'm not a Roman Catholic, because that's where this man is coming from. He's coming out of Rome. And we may say, well, we don't follow him. You know, we don't ascribe to his doctrine, but most of the world does subscribe. Even Muslims, you know, they don't know it, but they follow Rome too. The fake Jews, they follow Rome. You know how the Pope got that little thing, with that little thing on his head, and that's what y'all see Eden with too? Mm-hmm. They get it from Rome. You know, what's the name? The Pope told you you're going to heaven when you die. What a Muslim thing they going when they die. And they going to heaven, they going to get them 72 virgins with sweaty bosoms. Look it up. But that's just what that's what Sunday church say. They say the same exact thing. They got their doctrine coming from Rome. See, we're the only ones that don't fit the picture. We're the only ones that don't fit it. But he is already, you know, he's already doing his job now. He's just in, you know, he's just kind of laying low right now. But it's going to be a time when he's going to be made known. But 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, go and pick it up at verse 1.
Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
So the conversation is about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why I said we beg you, brethren, or beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And what else?
And by our gathering together unto him. That ye be not soon taken in mind.
Taken in mind, go ahead.
Or be troubled. Neither by spirit.
Go ahead.
Nor by word. Nor by letter as from us.
So don't let nobody throw you off when it comes to the Lord return. He said, don't be shaken, don't be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that what?
As that the day of Christ is at hand.
Verse 3.
Let no man deceive you by any means.
So that's the same thing Jesus said concerning what? His second coming. So Paul's saying the same thing. He said, let no man deceive you by any means. It may look good. It may sound good. Like tomorrow, the world go for it. They go for those things, man. He got them good. There's another guy, this Chinese guy. I think he's in Japan or something. Man, he got like a big stadium just like Osteen, man. You know, but the world is deceived by these guys. And this is what Paul saying. He said, let no man deceive you by any means, what? Pertaining to Christ's returning. This is what we're talking about. Don't let nobody deceive you for what?
For that day shall not come. Except there come a falling away first.
So in order for this day to come, it got to be a falling away. And if you ain't paid attention lately, the world has fell away. We're talking about falling away from the gospel, the word of God. The world don't deal with the Bible system, brother. So that's how you know we're in this time. So he said, let no man deceive you, for that day should not come except there come a falling away first. And what else?
And that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition.
So we talking about the Lord stepping foot back on this earth. When he going to step foot back in this earth? When is this man going to be revealed? But keep reading verse 4. We'll look at it.
Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God.
So notice another name for him, the son of perdition or destruction, the abomination of desolation. But what he do, why is he called this? Because he do what? He said he opposed and exalted himself above all that is called God. Go ahead.
Or that is worship. so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God.
That's right, go ahead.
Showing himself that he is God.
That's right, so, you know, an abominable act system, brother. You know, you blaspheming against the Lord, and this is what this man gonna do, so this is why he got this title. Then he gonna go into destruction and start taking down the world. So he gonna sit in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So it's a place where he gonna sit at. The temple that we talking about is the temple that they gonna build, which is what they trying to get ready now. You know, and this is where he gonna come over at, and he gonna sit in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. This is the man of sin, the abomination, the desolation. Verse 5, and go ahead.
Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. And now you knew that withheld it, that it might be revealed in his time.
So he gonna be revealed now. He said, now you know, where withhold it, that he might be revealed in his time. So slowly, the revelation of this man is starting to unfold, but, you know, it's gonna be a time when he's really gonna be made known. Keep reading.
For the mystery of iniquity doth already work.
So the mystery is already in the works. It's already taking place. But notice what they call it. They call him a mystery of iniquity, a mystery of sin, because the world don't know about it. The world ain't paying attention. The world think he the holiest man in the world. But actually, he the king of the world. And guess what? He get his power from Satan. But that's why he is the mystery of iniquity. So keep reading. Go ahead.
Only he who know letteth will let.
Only he who now letteth will let, which is the Lord. The Lord is allowing this to happen. He's letting this take place until when?
Until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed.
Oh, so that's when he's going to be revealed. You know, so the world going to follow him all the way to the end before they really find out. It's going to be too late. When the Lord get back, they're going to take that mark of the beast. And they're going to say, oh, that's him right there, the one that's going into the fire. Oh, I didn't know. That's your bad. That's why the Lord told you to read. What it say? Study and show yourself approved. You can't take my word for it. You can't take, you know, any of the teacher's word for it. You got to sit down and you got to study for yourself. Because at the end of the day, you're going to stand up before the Lord. You got to answer for all the choices and decisions that you make. So he said, and then shall that wicked be revealed whom what?
Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth. And shall destroy with the brightness of his coming.
That's right. Now let's go a little, let's go into Daniel chapter 7. Let's see what this man of sin going to do. Let's see another reason why he's going to be called the abomination of the desolation. Or the son of perdition. Robert saw that he's going to oppose himself against all that is called God. He's going to sit in the temple of God, showing that he is God. Daniel 7 and 21. Read that one verse right there. What else he going to do?
I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints.
So this same horn, this abomination of desolation, he's going to make war with the saints. The reason why I call him a horn, because he's a part of the, you know, the last part of this Gentile dynasty. All right? And Rome had, you know, 10 horns or 10 men that tried to, you know, revive Rome. You know, when he came up, he took down three of those kings. That's what the horns represent, kings. He took down three of those kings, but he did not operate like the other seven did. He didn't operate like them. He operated religiously. He operated in the mind. That's why he considered that little horn, but he's still a part of this dynasty. So at the end, when we get ready to, when the Lord get ready to return, notice what he said. He said, I beheld in the same horn, the same horn that, you know, that the angel was telling, that Daniel dreamed about earlier in this chapter. Like I told you, I didn't want to go too much into it today, you know. But you can go back and read and you will see that this little horn came up. Well, this little horn right here is the one that's going to make war with the saints. The saints ain't going to be in heaven. The saints going to be in on this earth when the great tribulation takes place. And if you wise enough, you will be able, the Lord, and we not only wise enough, but we blessed that the Lord allows us to get to the place of safety, then we won't have to fall in this this category. But, you know, it's going to be some saints that's not going to make it out of here. That's why he said, I beheld the same horn made war with the saints and did what?
And prevailed against them.
And he going to win. He going to beat them down. But skip down to verse 25. That ain't in the class, but read that verse 25 right quick.
And he shall speak great words against the Most High.
So another reason why he called the abomination the desolation. Said because he going to speak great words against the Most High. And what else?
And shall wear out the saints of the Most High.
Oh, so he's still wearing these saints out. He still, the saints ain't getting away with it. See, this is why you know, this is why it was so important for me today. I just wanted to make sure we understand that the Lord got a way for you to get out of here. The Lord got a way for you to escape, but you just have to be willing. Your faith, see, if your faith ain't on point right now, and I'm going to tell you something, my faith ain't on point like that. It ain't, I'd be lying to you if I said, well, if my faith is on point, I'd be walking around in the hospital trying to heal people. You know, so that lets you know my faith ain't there. You know, but you still have to work toward it, because when the time comes, if your faith ain't strong enough, you're going to get caught up in this time frame. And you don't want to get caught. But this is why the Lord is giving us the information on what we need to do to save ourselves. So notice what he said. He says, he going verse 25, he's going to speak great words against the Most High. And he already doing it. You know, this is why most of the church tell we don't got to keep no commandments. We don't got to do nothing. You know, the Bible is a fable. That's what he say now. You know, but like I say, this may not even be the guy, but it's still coming from that office. So he said he's going to speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, because this is who he's coming for during the time of the great tribulation. This is what this is all about, to take down the saints, sisters, bro.
But keep reading. And think to change times and laws.
Right now, you know, right now he's subtly doing it. You know, like we can conveniently not worship on Sunday. We can say we ain't taking part of that nonsense, that folly that y'all do on Sunday. You know, we can conveniently, or we can do that by choice now. But when he have this power to go into the great tribulation, all the choices off the table. You going to serve him or you going to die. That's why he say he going to speak great words against the Most High, and he going to wear out the saints of the Most High and think to change times and laws. So it's going to come a time where you're going to have to worship on. Okay, you talking about you going to worship, you got to keep the Sabbath day. No, they ain't having that. See, that's why it's so important for you to get your faith up. But all you got to do is pay attention now. Look at some of the calendars now. They got Sunday as the seventh day now. Mm-hmm. It's never been that way since we was coming up. Sunday was always the first day of the week. Mm-hmm. You know, I can pull up my phone right now and you'll see Sunday on the calendar at the back. And Monday is the first day. But that's not according to, you know, that's not how we've been taught up, but that's what's starting to happen. They started, you know, we starting to see it become prevalent now. Times and laws being changed. But what's going to happen to these saints? Go ahead and read.
And they shall be given into his hand.
Uh-huh.
Until a time and times and the dividing of time.
All right, so that time we're talking about, because the saints going to be given into his hand until a time, which is 1 year, a times, which is 2 years, and a dividing time. So we got a total of 3.5 years. This is how long this great tribulation going to go on. All right, it's not going on for 7 years. You know, the Lord ain't going to have it going on for 7 years and he come back in the middle of it and grab the church and take you off to heaven, and then they're going to keep fighting. Now, by the time the 3.5 years over, the Lord going to come back and he bring his destruction. And that's it. All right, so now let's go a little bit further. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 24. Let's go back to Matthew 24 and look at the sign again. And what is supposed to be our response once this happens? Matthew chapter 24, go ahead and pick this up at verse 15. All right, you go ahead.
When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet,
uh-huh,
stand in the holy place,
mm-hmm,
whoso readeth, let him understand.
Okay, so it said when you see him stand in the holy place, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, whoso readeth, let him understand. We're going to find out about that. But this is that man, that abomination or desolation. But what are we supposed to do at this time? Verse 16, go ahead.
Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains.
Okay, so when this man stand in the holy place, you got a sign that you got to run, right? Now, as we look at the scripture, this looked like it just pertained to those over in Israel. That's why I said, then let them which be in Judea or Judah flee into the mountains. So in other words, they got to run. That's what flee mean. It mean run. It don't mean wait for no rapture. You know what I'm saying? It don't mean meet up at 6 o'clock downtown Atlanta, Centennial Park, waiting for the Lord to return. It mean run. But, you know, you got some preachers out here saying that this ain't got nothing to do with us. This is talking about the people over in Israel. Now, the question was, what's going to be the sign of your coming at the end of the world? This pertains to all of us. However, in this particular case right here, this is talking about the people who happen to be in this specific location. But we don't get down to us, because we got to get somewhere also. All right? So he said, then let them which be in Judea, whoever's in the land at this time, you need to get out of Israel, flee into the mountains. The mountains we talking about is Mount Zion, or Mount Sinai. The same mountain that the Lord, when he delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, he took them into the wilderness. That's the same place we got to get to at the end. That's the same place where the Lord returned, he going to meet the church in Mount Sinai. He's not going to meet him in Israel. He's going to do it the same way he did it last time. So he said, flee into the mountains, verse 17, go ahead.
Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house.
So notice what he said. He said, whoever's on the housetop, and not, you know, maybe people on the housetop, but what the Lord is doing, he's just letting you know how urgent this is, how serious this is. When you come down, listen, take off. Don't go into the house to get anything. That's why I tell people as we get ready to approach this time, you know, I'm not turning around and come get nobody. The reason why, because the Lord gave you signs and he gave you a countdown. You know, when they first, this is a little off the lesson, but just so you know how good God is, he let you know that when the people that call themselves Jews, when they start sacrificing animals, the day they start sacrificing animals, you got 2,300 days before the Lord set foot back on this earth. You can start counting down 2,300 days. So when you see them start sacrificing animals, that's your sign right there. Not just for me, that's a sign for all of us. And then when we see Jerusalem, when the armies get ready to come over there to set the abomination and the desolation up, we know it's time for us to run. But as we start embarking on this time, you know, as a church, we getting ready. We getting our running shoes ready. We getting ready to start fleeing. So when he say, let him which is on the housetop not come down and take anything out of his house, you come and, you know, somebody called me and said, well, the sister got left or the brother got left. Well, I got to save myself. You know, but at the same time, we're going to be trying to encourage one another up until that point. Because the Lord is letting you know that this is a bad time. That's why it's called, what, the Great Tribulation, the Hour of Temptation, Jacob's Trouble. It's all bad. Ain't no good in this at all. Ain't no good in this time. It's all bad. So it said what? Verse 18.
Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes.
So don't think about it. Don't do like Lot's wife. You know, even going back to get your clothes. But Lot's wife, what, she looked back. You know, the Lord turned her into a pillar of salt. Just letting you know, if you look back, you try to turn back, you get caught up in this thing, you lose your life. It's time for you to run. You got to flee. So he said, neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes, verse 19.
And woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days.
That's right, because it's going to be a bad time. We're talking about a woman that got a young child and trying to, you know, breastfeeding the child at this time. It's going to be a hard time. So that's why I say, woe unto them that are with child, and to them that get suck in those days. But you just got, you got to faith the Lord to get you out of here, though. But it's still going to be hard. Either way, it goes going to be hard for all of us. Now see, you trying to run, you know, we're going to look in Revelation today how, you know, Satan going to send an army behind us. He's going to send out a flood after us, just like he did with Israel back in the day. The same thing he's going to do. All right, but verse 20, go ahead.
But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. For then shall be great tribulation.
So we know that the Sabbath is going to still be around, and this is all pertaining to the land, but even over here, we just want to make sure we're on point when it's time for us to flee. So verse 21, it says, for what? For then shall be great tribulation. At this time, when the abomination of desolation stand in the holy place, it's going to be great tribulation. This is what's going to jump everything up. All right, go ahead, keep reading.
Such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time.
Go ahead.
No, nor ever shall be.
That's right. So even with the Lord flooding the earth, you know, when he took out man during the days of Noah, even with the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, all the way down to Pearl Harbor, you know, Hiroshima, you know, 9/11, even the captivity, us coming across on the land slave trade. Notice what the book said. He said it's going to be great tribulation, right? Such as was not since the beginning of the world. To this time, no, nor ever shall be. So there's been a lot of atrocities that have taken place throughout the world. But it ain't nothing compared to what this great tribulation is going to introduce. Verse 22, and go ahead.
And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved.
That's right. So the Lord going to have to shorten these days. See, ultimately, at the end of the day, the kings of the world, they're going to, you know, they get high and mighty and pumped up, and they all got nuclear weapons, so they can wipe everybody out. But the Lord know that. That's why he's saying, except those days be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. But for what?
But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened.
That's right, because he got to save Israel. Remember, he made a covenant with Abraham, and he's not going to allow everybody to be taken out. But let's go a little further. We got to look at this holy place, because the Bible tells you in 15, it says, when you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. All right, let's go find out what the holy place is. Let's go over to Ezekiel chapter 21. Ezekiel chapter 21. And this is like just putting the pieces to the puzzle together so you have a better understanding. You know, you'll have a little bit more knowledge than you had before you came, you know, pertaining to this particular issue. Next week, Lord willing, Jediah going to do the one on the two wildernesses. So this right here, just to kind of brush you up, you know, so you'll be ready. So, you know, you'll kind of, you know, they go hand in hand with one another. So that's why we ain't really got to go into all the seals and all that type of stuff, but we just looking at the time frame itself. So Ezekiel chapter 21, pick it up at start at verse 1.
Okay.
Go ahead.
And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face toward Jerusalem.
Son of man, set thy face toward Jerusalem. What else?
And drop thy word towards the holy place.
Oh, drop thy word toward the holy places. See, the holy places in Israel, in Jerusalem. But notice what it says. It says holy places, right?
Mm-hmm.
See, he going to sit in the holy place. He's not going to sit in the temple where the Lord going to sit at. That's why in Revelation, he was telling them to measure the temple and the court that is without. Measure it not. It is given to the Gentiles. But he's not going to sit in the most holy place, but he's going to sit in the holy place in the land of Israel. That's where it's at. So when y'all see this man come to Jerusalem, or you see the armies get ready to go into Jerusalem and start surrounding Jerusalem, you know, he's talking about the Roman armies, all right? Or the European Union army, because the European Union ain't going to have an army, you know, that's going to made up of 10 nations, and it's going to represent them as a whole. But when they get over to Jerusalem, you know it's time for you to run. You got 30 days from that point. Once they get over there, to run. Get to the wilderness. But we're going to look at that. But this is what I want to show you, you know, so when you see the abomination of desolation standing in the holy place. So we know that, you know, according to what we read, he says, Son of man, set thy face toward Jerusalem and drop thy word toward the holy places and whatever.
And prophesy against the holy land, the land of Israel.
All right, let's go to Isaiah chapter 24. Isaiah chapter 24. We're going to see why the Lord is going to allow this to happen. You know, a lot of people like to say the Lord love everybody. The Lord wouldn't do that. You know, but they don't know the Lord. You know, and it's just like, you look at today and it's just like the Lord, you know, people sit back and say, well, why the Lord allow this to happen? You know, well, it's a lot of evil going on. Man is full of sin. You know, and the Lord, at the same time, even though things are happening in the world, he's still giving people a chance. But, you know, the Lord is a righteous judge. We can't put it all on him because man is making these choices themselves. Go and pick it up at verse 1. Let's see.
Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty.
Uh-huh, and that's what's going to happen. The Lord going to make the earth empty. You know, see, the kings of the world, they think they're going to keep it going on. That's why they're trying to come up with ways now. You know, to see if we can, they try to come up with ways where people can live forever now. See, man trying to be God, but it ain't going to happen. You know, they feel like their kingdom is going to go on forever. That's why when Jesus gets back, they're going to try to fight Jesus. Because they ain't going to want to give up the kingdom, give up this world. So he said, behold, the Lord going to do what? Make the earth empty and what else?
And maketh it waste.
Uh-huh.
And turneth it upside down.
Mm-hmm.
And scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof.
That's right, go ahead.
And it shall be as with the people, so with the priest.
Uh-huh.
As with the servant, so with the master.
So no matter what the position is, it's going to consume everybody. He says, it shall be as with the people, so with the priest. As with the servant, so with his master. What else?
As with the maid,
mm-hmm.
so with the mistress.
That's right. Go ahead.
As with the buyer, so with the seller.
Mm-hmm.
As with the lender, so with the borrower.
Mm-hmm.
As with the taker of usury, so with the giver of usury to him.
So it's going to consume everybody. Ain't nobody getting away with it, in other words. All right, verse 3.
The land shall be utterly empty and utterly spoiled.
Uh-huh.
For the Lord hath spoken this word.
That's right. So it got to come to pass. You can't, you know, you can't pray and ask the Lord to stop it. Like you had a doomsday preface. Then you had the people that be wanting to save America so bad. You know, they people, you know, especially the Gentiles that run the world, you know, have money and wealth built up or passed down from their fathers. They just feel like, you know, they can pray and turn back to God and Lord to stop it. It's already, the ball already rolling, and it's rolling downhill. Matter of fact, it's a boulder rolling downhill. Lord ain't finna turn around and push it back up. Nah, it's coming down. So you can pray all you want to. The Bible says what? It says the earth mourneth and fade away, the world languish. No, I'm sorry, verse 3, it says the land shall utterly be empty, be utterly empty, and utterly spoiled, for the Lord has spoken this word. So it done already went forth. Ain't nothing you can do about it. All you can do is, you know, try to find out what you got to do to protect yourself from the wrath of the Lord. But verse 4, go ahead.
The earth mourneth and fadeth away. Mm-hmm. The world languisheth and fadeth away.
That's right.
The haughty people of the earth do languish.
That's right. Go ahead.
The earth also is defiled under the inhabitants thereof.
So the Lord got to clean it up. That's why he gonna empty it out. He said the earth is also is defiled under the inhabitants thereof. Because they what?
Because they have transgressed the law.
Because they've broken the law. And that's what they say? That you ain't got to keep the law no more? Mm-hmm. See, we in the Old Testament, the Lord telling you what's going to happen at the end, but he got a controversy with the world because what? It says that they, because they have transgressed the laws, what else?
Changed the ordinance. Uh-huh. Broken the everlasting covenant.
And what got to happen because of it?
Therefore hath the curse devoured the earth. Uh-huh. And they that dwell therein are desolate.
Oh, so much for not keeping the Sabbath. So much for you can eat anything, just pray over. See, they think that the Lord ain't paying attention. The Lord watching all this stuff, sisters and brothers. But at the same time, while he allowed things to go on, he also allowed, you know, people to wake up and start turning back to the Lord. Because once he started pouring out his wrath, he gonna empty this world out. That's why I say they therefore have the curse devoured the earth. And they that dwell therein are desolate. What else?
Therefore the inhabitants of the earth are burned.
Uh-huh. The inhabitants of the earth are burned. And what else?
And few men left.
And when the Lord gets back, ain't gonna be that many men left. It tell you that. This man gonna be like an Ophir, a goat. Which I'm quite sure none of us have ever seen. Why? Because it's so few. But it said, and few men left. And it's going to happen because the world has broken the Lord's covenant. So now let's go over to Revelation chapter 3. Let's look at another name for this. Another name for this great tribulation. When you look at this in Revelation chapter 3, there's a letter going out to the seven churches by way of the angels. But we're going to look at this particular church, the church of Philadelphia, and notice what the Lord is going to tell them. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, and go and pick this up at verse 7.
To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, mm-hmm. These things saith he that is holy.
Go ahead.
He that is true.
Uh-huh.
He that hath the key of David.
Uh-huh.
He that openeth, and no man shut.
Uh-huh. So this is the Lord talking, and he's telling the angel to go write this to the church in Philadelphia. Go say this to the, write these things that, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true. He that have the key of David, he that opened no man shut. This talking about Jesus here. But he tells him to go speak this to the church in Philadelphia. Go ahead and read.
And shutteth, and no man opened.
Uh-huh.
I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door.
Uh-huh.
And no man can shut it.
That's right. So we just talking about the Lord giving this church the word of God. And can't no man take it from him. That's why I say I open the door. Remember, he say somewhere else in the word. In the word, he say what? Not and the door shall be open. Mm-hmm. And I also tell you to open up the door and I come in and sup with you. So we see here he's saying, I know thy works, talking about, well, we ain't gonna open it, let the cat out of the bag yet. But he said, I know thy words, go ahead. Before, behold, I set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For what?
But thou hast a little strength.
Uh-huh.
And hast kept my word.
Go ahead. So we're gonna find out who is this he talking about that got a little strength, but have kept his word and not what?
And has not denied my name.
Uh-huh, go ahead.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan,
mm-hmm.
which say they are Jews and are not.
Okay, so he's saying what? The Lord is letting you know. He said, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not. Now you look around the world, there's only one nation of people that call themselves Jews. See, we know we the Israelites according to the Bible. You know, by where the curses and how they came on us You know, it only fits one nation of people, but we still, as a whole, call ourselves African American. You know, a black, a colored, a Negro, you know, a dog, but we don't call ourselves, you know, no Jew. It's only one nation of people that call themselves Jew, and the Lord knew this was going to happen. This is why he says, behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do what?
But do lie.
Uh-huh.
Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved
them. All right, so now, I just want to go off script right quick. Let's go with Isaiah chapter 62, because I want to show y'all that even in the Old Testament, you know, they knew that this was going to happen. But this fits us today. I'm going to show you how good the Lord is, you know, because he's leaving in the Bible, and you can't miss, you cannot go wrong with the identification of this people. But even though you can't go wrong with the identification of people, you also can find out who is the one that's doing the lying. So Isaiah chapter 63. So let's pick this up at, start at verse 17. Isaiah 63 verse 17.
63:17.
Uh-huh.
O Lord, why hast thou made us to err from thy ways?
Go ahead. He said, Lord, why have you made us to err from our ways? We know that the Lord didn't make us err from our ways, but this is Isaiah talking on behalf of Israel. Mm-hmm. O Lord, why hast thou made us to err from thy ways and what?
And harden our heart from thy fear.
Uh-huh.
Return for thy servant's sake.
Uh-huh.
The tribe of thine inheritance.
That's right. So he's saying return and give back to the tribe their inheritance. Because you look around at us today, it's like we're lost people and we ain't got no IN is bad from the looks of it. But go ahead and read. Verse 18.
The people of thy holiness have possessed it but a little while.
That's right, because for the most part we've been slaves all this time, but we possessed the land for a little while. We went right into the land. Our forefathers went in and what? They sinned against God. Lord kicked them right out. And we've been in captivity ever since. So he said, you know, we have possessed it but a little while. Go ahead and read.
Our adversaries have trodden down thy sanctuary.
That's right. So our enemies have taken down our sanctuary. See, we're not in the land today. Our enemies in the land today. Our adversaries, the ones who are against us, they what? They in our land and saying they Israel. He said, they what? He said, our adversaries have trodden down thy sanctuary. What else?
We are thine.
So notice what he said. We are thine. Not them. We are your people. Can you read?
Thou never bearest rule over them.
And he has not. The Lord ain't never bear rule over them. He bear rule over Israel. And what else he say?
They were not called by thy name.
They were not called by thy name. That's why we look at in Revelation chapter 3 here. He said, well, they're the house of the synagogue of Satan. They weren't called by the Lord's name. But see, the Lord even pointed this out to you way in Isaiah before we even get to the New Testament, because it's been going on for a while. So now let's go back over to Revelation chapter 3. In Revelation 3 verse 9, it said, please don't touch that, bro. It's hot up here. Please, yeah, you might want to sit back there. He said, it's two of them, so you got to calm the one down in the back. Yeah, but up here it's kind of hot. He said, behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Talking about Israel, the real Jews. Mm-hmm. But what else he say? Verse 10.
Because thou hast kept the word of my patience.
Uh-huh, because you kept the word of my patience. And that's what we're doing. We're keeping the word of his patience, not just as an individual nation, but as a church. See, the body makes up Israel. Spiritually. Physically, we are made up as a nation. But, you know, you being the nation of Israel physically, you got to, you know, come on to that other side spiritually, circumcise your heart and your mind and start keeping these commandments. Then you get, you know, put into the church. So it said, because thou hast kept the word in my patience, I will also do what?
I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation.
Oh, so he going to keep you from the hour of temptation. See, we're not talking about a day. We're not talking about a literal 60 minutes. We're talking about a time that's going to come on this earth that's going to last for 3.5 years. So he said, I'm going to keep you from the hour of temptation, which going to do what?
Which shall come upon all the world.
Uh-huh.
To try thee.
Oh, so it's going to come upon all the world to do what?
To try them.
That
dwell upon the earth.
So since you want to worship other gods, since you want to lay down with this harlot, you want to, you know, break my commandments and break the covenant and stuff like that, don't do what the Lord tell you to do, or the Lord going to allow this abomination of desolation, or this man of sin, the son of perdition, to come on this world. And another name for it is called the hour of temptation. And notice what he said. It's gonna come on the world to try them that dwell upon earth. That's what it's all about. People say they love God, but you ain't doing what it say. Well, this is your opportunity to show them you really love God or not. But notice what he said. He's going to keep the church now. This church in Philadelphia, he said, I'm going to keep you from the hour of temptation. Now, you read the other six churches. The other six churches ain't so blessed to be a part of this, you know, to escape this time. So hopefully we fall into the church of Philadelphia. All right, so now let's go a little further. Let's go over to Daniel chapter 11. Let's look at this hour of temptation, because he said he's going to let it come on the world to try them, right? So let's look at what's going to happen during this time. Daniel chapter 11. Mm-hmm. We're going to pick it up at verse 31, I believe. Sure.
An arm shall stand on his porch.
Uh-huh. So when we talk about this man, abomination, desolation gonna come. Lord, like I said, Lord gonna lighten and try the whole world. But notice what he say. Remember, we is in Matthew 24, right? And in Matthew 24, it say, when you see the abomination, the desolation stand in the holy place, right? Mm-hmm. Know that the desolation thereof is now. All right. So now we're looking at how he's gonna stand in the holy place. Read that again from the top.
An arm shall stand on his porch.
So the arms that we see, we talking about arms. Army's going to stand on his part. Army's going to come into the land first as a representation of this Pope. See, and I have to make sure I clear this up all the time. The Lord told you to go back and read Daniel. That's why I say, whoso readeth, let him understand, right? Now, if the Pope stand in the holy place, and you still here when he stand up, we're talking about the Pope standing himself, then you did not get out of here in time. Because once the Pope stands there, that's when he stands up as God, and that's when the Great Tribulation starts. All right, so if you want an example of how it's going to be done, you know, you can put it in your notes and look at Luke chapter 21. And they ask the same question about, you know, the same question that was in Matthew 24. They asked, you know, Luke gave you his account of it in Luke chapter 21. And, you know, regarding the coming of the Lord, when shall these things be and things like that. And Luke, you know, the Lord, the account that Luke put down was pertaining to Jesus responding about when they're going to take down Jerusalem in 70 A.D. And what Jesus told them, he said, when you see Jerusalem compassed round about with armies, know that the desolation thereof is not. All right? Well, that's the same way it's going to happen at the end. When you see the armies come, that's why it says here in 31, an arm's going to stand on this part. What else they going to do? Keep reading.
And they shall pollute the sanctuary.
So they're going to pollute the sanctuary. They're going to come over there. Because the armies got to come first. They're going to stand on this part. In other words, they're coming as a representative, as the Pope first. They're going to stand on this part. Because see, once they get there, now it's your time for you to start running. Now it's time for you to get out, because you got a particular time frame, which is 30 days, for you to get to the place of safety. So I say, arms going to stand on this part. They're going to pollute the sanctuary of strength and what else?
And they shall take away the daily sacrifice.
So they're going to stop the daily sacrifice, because these people in the land, the people in the land today, they're going to start sacrificing animals. That's why I was telling y'all earlier, when they start sacrificing animals, you got 2,300 days until Jesus set foot back on this earth. Alright, but these armies here, they gonna come over there and they gonna what? They gonna stop the daily sacrifice, and after they stop the daily sacrifice, what they gonna do now?
And they shall place the abomination that make them.
So once they place the abomination, that's it. It done all that. Soon as they place him as the king of the world or as God, that's it. That starts the Great Tribulation. So you don't wait till he get there for you to run. What you do is when you see the armies get there, now it's time for you to run. It's time for you to run at this time, because notice what it says. It says arms gonna stand on his part. You go into another place, once he get into the temple, he gonna stand as God, showing himself that he is God. That's it right there, it starts right there. If you wait till that time for the Pope himself to get there, then you don't miss the boat. All right, so watch the armies. When the armies get there and start surrounding Jerusalem, just like they did in Luke 21, that's your time to flee. That's why in Luke 21, the Lord said what? Don't come in. When you see them Jerusalem compassed around by one army, don't, whoever in the city, get out. If you in the city, don't come. If you are in the woods or whatever, you fall out. Do not come in. So likewise, when you see them armies come down there, it's time for you to get out of there. If you in the city, get out of there. That's why Matthew 24, it told you what? It's time for you to flee into the mountain. But you can't flee if he done started the great tribulation. You caught. It's too late. So I just want to make sure we understand. All right, so now let's go a little bit further. Let's go over to, well, keep reading. Keep reading, brother. Verse 2.
32.
Uh-huh.
And such as do wickedly against the covenant, mm-hmm. shall he corrupt by flatteries.
Uh-huh. So the ones that don't keep the commandments, they're going to be corrupted. They're going to fall for the flattery. They're going to fall for the deceit. But keep reading.
But the people that do know their God, mm-hmm. shall be strong and do exploits.
Uh-huh. So they're going to explore him. They're going to be strong. But these are the ones who can make it out of here. All right. Well, go ahead.
And they that understand among the people shall instruct many.
Uh-huh.
Yet they shall fall by the sword,
uh-huh.
and by flame.
So see, these are some of the saints that are going to be beheaded for the witness of Jesus. So that's why I said, what, they don't understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by flame, by captivity and by spoil many days. So this, the trouble that got to come with you serving God. And you happen to be in this great tribulation. But verse 34.
Now when they shall fall,
uh-huh.
they shall be hoping with a little help.
Mm-hmm.
But many shall cleave to them with flattery.
That's right, go ahead.
And some of them of understanding shall fall,
uh-huh.
to try them and to purge.
Okay, notice what he say now. And see, we also got our temptation. And doing this our temptation, this is really a purge. You know, that's why I always make reference to that movie that they got called The Purge. You know, ain't no purge like the one the Lord getting ready to write. You know, but this is what it's called the purge, because the Lord, notice what he's saying. He said some of them of understanding shall fall. So we know ones in the Word of God, they're going to fall. They're going to die for the Word of God. But why the Lord going to allow this? To try them. Not to try the ones, not to try the saints. It's to try the ones in this great tribulation who say, okay, Lord, I'll serve you. I'm gonna go ahead and start keeping your commandments now. Okay, well, when that saint in front of you get his head cut off, let's see if you're going to have the same story. That's why he says what? He says, and some of them of understanding shall fall, to try them and to purge and to do what?
And to make them white.
Uh-huh.
Even to the time of the end.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is yet for a time appointed.
That's right. That's coming up in our time. But even during this time of the great tribulation, you're going to have a lot of people that's going to turn to the Lord. And then you're going to have a lot of people that's going to take the mark of the beast. All right, so let's go a little further. Let's go over to Habakkuk. You might have to go into your table of contents.
Yeah.
Because I think I got to get none, too. It's okay. At least we read. Right from Zephaniah. DeMarcus ain't right from Zephaniah. Some might have to go into contents for that. That's right from Zechariah. Come back. At least we read, that's what matters. I got your CD too, brother.
I got it.
I think you left it on the thing.
Oh,
brother behind you.
Oh, this one.
I'm back at the chapter, pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead.
The burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see.
Uh-huh. So notice what, now this is the burden which Habakkuk did see. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Y'all fail for that. Y'all don't say amen.
You know, like, look at you, I'm like, wait a minute, hold it.
I gotta get out of our tall system, man. Oh, man. Come back, that scared me. Come back in chapter 1. Everybody there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Come back in chapter 1. Let's go and pick this up at verse 5.
Behold, ye among the heathen, and regard, and wonder marvelously.
Go ahead.
For I will work a work in your days, which ye will not believe, though it be told you. For lo, I rise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation.
So notice what it said. He said, behold, ye among the heathen. Behold, pay attention, you who are among the heathen, and regard, and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days, which ye will not believe, though it be told you. So it's only one of us that's among the heathen. We're going to find out who this is among the heathen. But he said, for lo, I'm going to raise up who? The Chaldeans. Y'all know the Chaldeans is? Another name for Babylon, or the Babylonians called Chaldeans. We're not talking about that came out of Nimrod. We're talking about the one that from the Gentile dynasty. All right, so he said, for lo, I raise up the Chaldeans that what?
That bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land, to possess the dwelling place that are not theirs.
That's right, go ahead.
They are terrible and dreadful. Their judgment and their dignity shall proceed of themselves. Their horses also are swifter than the leopards, and are more fierce than the evening wolves. And their horsemen shall spread themselves, and their horsemen shall come from far. They shall fly as the eagle that hasteth to eat. They shall come all for violence. Their faces shall sup up as the east wind, and they shall gather the captivity as the sand.
All right, so this took place back in the day, and it's also related to our time. But we're going to see what the Lord is using them for. We see that they're full of wickedness. We see that they are, you know, they're going to come swift and fly as the eagle that hastes to eat. And in verse 9, it says they shall come for all for violence. They're coming to kill. Their faces shall sup up as the east wind. They shall gather the captivity as the sand. And what else? Verse 10.
And they shall scoff at the kings. And the princes shall be a scorn unto them. They shall deride every strong hold, for they shall heap dust and take it. Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing this his power unto his God.
That's right. That's kind of like with Nebuchadnezzar. What he did, he didn't serve the true living God. What he made it seem like he had put the kingdom together. Well, this is what's happening right here. They said they're imputing this power unto his God, not the true living God. As a matter of fact, the Lord is the one that set them up, whether you know it or not. All evil that's going on in the world about where the Romans, you know, how they hold and got the world, you know, under their thumb, the Lord is the one that allowed it. Notice what he says, verse 12.
Art thou not from everlasting, O Lord my God?
Go ahead.
Mine holy one, we shall not die. O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment.
Oh, so notice what the Lord put them up there for. Read that again. He did what?
O Lord, that thou hast ordained them for judgment.
See, the Lord put nations in power to whoop other nations. He said, Lord, O Lord, thou hast what? Thou hast ordained them for judgment. So even all the way down to the end, when we get into this great tribulation, this same nation the Lord going to use to come against the world. So he said, O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment. What else?
And, Almighty God, thou hast established them for correction.
That's right. So that's what the Lord got this nation set up for correction, to whoop down the world. So, you know, you can gather all the guns and, you know, try to do all the stuff you want to. I still hear people talking about it. I'm telling y'all, when I first came, not in the Word, but when I first, when I first, started, I don't know what you call it, I guess started searching or whatever. I was trying to get the guns and all that type of stuff, thinking I was going to even try to leave. I don't know what was going, but I was going to try to leave America. But the Lord got them running the whole world. And notice what he used them for. He said, thou hast established them for correction. So you can't get out of it. You know, you go back over to Jeremiah chapter 27 and 25, even chapter 4, and he tells you how he's going to bring this nation up. But the Chaldeans is Babylon. They are the ones that the Lord's going to use for correction. That's why he's saying in Revelation 3, he's going to bring the outward temptation on the world to try the world. It's called the Great Tribulation, called Jacob's Trouble System, though. But he said, ye among the heathen, in verse 5, he said, behold, ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days. This is even talking about during our time. And we're going to see the work that he's going to work in our days. See, the work that he gonna work, he gonna allow this destruction to come, but he's still gonna be the help of Jacob at the end. But go ahead to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy 4. And we're going to pick this up at verse 1. All right, we can go ahead and read, bro. Now, I know everybody probably thinking, well, how are we going to get out of here? Where is it at? How are we going to escape? Well, the Lord gonna make a way. We're going to look at some of it today, though. But Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 1. Go ahead and read.
Now, therefore, hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments which I teach you, for to do them, that ye may live and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers giveth. Ye shall not add unto the words which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you.
Okay, so what did he say? Keep the commandments. That's what this is about, right? He said, you should not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord. If you do that, the Lord is going to let them go into the land that he promised to their father. But we drop the ball. We skip down to verse 26. If we don't do it, what's going to happen? Verse 26, let's see.
I call heaven and earth to witness against you this day, that ye shall soon utterly perish from off the land whereunto ye go over Jordan to possess it.
So when you go over to the land, if you happen to break the commandments, then the Lord is going to kick you out the land. That's why we're not in the land today, right?
Right.
He said, you're going to soon utterly perish from off the land whereunto you go over Jordan to possess it. You shall not what?
You shall not prolong your days upon it, but shall utterly be destroyed.
That's right. So you're a holy people, and we're in the holy land, and we start to sin, the Lord kick us out. Somebody else in there, you know, the Lord going to take them out eventually, but, you know, we supposed to be the nation that's supposed to set an example. So the Lord kicked us out the land. But what he did, verse 27.
And the Lord shall scatter you among the nations.
Oh, he going to scatter you among the nations. That's why we just saw in Habakkuk, when we just read, he said, what? Ye among the heathen. He said, the Lord going to scatter you among the nations, and what else?
And ye shall be left few in number among the heathen.
Oh, you're going to be scattered, and you're going to be left few in number among who? Among the heathen. So that's why the Lord said, going to work a work in your day, talking about us and doing our time, all the way down to our time. But go ahead and keep reading.
Whither the Lord shall lead, shall serve gods and the works of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither see, nor hear, nor eat, nor smell.
We got that on. We got that going on. Like it ain't nothing. But verse 29.
But if from this thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him.
That's what we're doing right now, right? But notice what he said. You got to seek the Lord. You know, it ain't just go listen to the pastor and, you know, he give you a feel-good sermon, give you a couple scriptures, and that's it. You know, you go home and you ain't learn nothing. You go home, supposed to be your Sabbath day, you're cooking fish dinners, you know, pork chop sandwiches, you know, all this type of abomination that's going on because you're listening to the pastor. And you feel like you ain't got to do nothing. But notice what he said. He said, it's from this where he scattered you at. Thou shalt seek the Lord thy God. That's what we're doing now. That's why I feel like when you come into the Word, boy, it feel like you've been running and looking and looking and looking, and you get it, and you feel like, I'm glad I'm here. I ain't got to look no more. But that's the point. You got to look. You got to search. So if from this thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him if thou do what?
If thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul.
That's right. Go ahead. Verse 30.
When thou art in tribulation and all these things are come upon thee.
So now just pay attention to something now. Now, when we talk about tribulation, we not, you know, we've been in trouble for a long time. Israel been going through tribulation for a long time, sisters and brothers. So what we're seeing right now that's happening throughout the world, this has always been on us. You know, but the Lord said what? He said, when thou art in tribulation and all these things that come upon thee, even when?
Even in the latter days.
So the Lord paying attention all the way down to what's going on now, sisters and brothers. You know, we understand, you know, a lot of stuff that's starting to happen to us, but the Lord watching it. The Lord watching it. That's why he say, But now the tribulation and all these things that come upon thee, even in the latter days, if thou turn to the Lord thy God and shall be obedient unto his voice. Keep reading, 31.
For the Lord thy God is a merciful God.
Uh-huh.
He will not forsake thee.
Oh, so he's not going to forsake you, neither what?
Neither destroy thee.
Uh-huh.
Nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he swore unto them.
That's right. So I just wanted to add that in there. Let you know that, you know, regardless how I seem, you know, it seems like we just ain't got no, we done for as a people. But Lord ain't forget the covenant. But we are the ones that he scattered among the heathen. This is why he told us in Habakkuk, he going to work a work in our day. And we seeing it. You know, we seeing some of the things happen now. We get ready to see the rise of the Roman Empire. And they get ready to come back. You know, and they slowly doing it. They're already making their way back. But the world just don't, you know, they don't pay attention to it, because the one that's leading the Roman Empire, he sound real nice to the world. He talk nice. You know, he wear the you know, little red robe and stuff like that. And people like that. People like sissies or something. You know what I'm saying? It's like they like people that talk soft and stuff like that. You know, but that's what the world wants. They got dimension in. But let's go on to Genesis chapter 32. Genesis chapter 32. I was having a conversation with some Jehovah's Witnesses a couple weeks ago. And I told him he was dealing with false doctrine. The guy said he ain't like the way I was talking to him. I said, man, I'm talking to you normal, man. You know what I'm saying? I'm saying, boy, look at him, man. They done made y'all out of, they done made these guys out of punk, man. You know, it's like, it's not us they really tripping on. It's us tripping. It's the word of God that we bring it. And it cut. It cut, so instead of them being mad at God, they be mad at the message. And all I'm doing is reading you what the scripture says. And I say to myself, man, how nice can you say it, man? Like, I got to say it with a smile on my face? For you to stop getting so offended, but it's really the word of God that get offended over. But Genesis chapter 32, and let's pick this up at verse 24. And let's see what happened when Jacob was coming back, getting ready to go back into his country, where his kinsmen are. And let's notice what's going to happen as he's waiting on his men to go try to please Esau. But Esau wanted to kill him because Jacob had got the blessing. So what he did was he sent them out to go, you know, try to give some presents to Esau so he can come on past through. So let's see what happened while he was waiting. Genesis 32 and verse 24. Go ahead and read, brother.
And Jacob was left alone.
Uh-huh.
And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day.
That's right. Go ahead.
And when he saw that he prevailed not against him,
mm-hmm.
he touched the hollow of his thigh.
Uh-huh. So Jacob wrestling with an angel. That's what's happening right here. But skip down to verse 27. Okay.
And he said unto him,
mm-hmm.
what is thy name?
Go ahead.
And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob.
Uh-huh. So Jacob, right? Jacob was his name. The angel told him what? You're not going to be called no more Jacob. Because, you know, if you look at when Isaac went to give out the blessing, Esau said to his father, he said, is not he rightly named Jacob because he supplanted me these two times? So we know that Jacob didn't supplant Esau. Just so y'all know. If y'all ever been taught that, and anybody watching online, y'all been taught that Jacob, you know, tricked Esau? No, he didn't. Esau, the Bible tell you, he despised his birthright. So the Lord hated him. Tell you that in Romans 9:13. You say, well, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. Then it tell you that Esau despised his birthright. But if you go read the story for yourself, you see that what happened when he was coming back from hunting that day, he asked Jacob for some food, right? A bowl of beans, a lentil, and then what did he say? What did Jacob say? Jacob said,
but Israel.
Now, hold on. He said, Jacob said to him, if you give me your birthright, I'll give you some of these beans. And then Jacob gave him the beans. And Esau gave him the birthright. So that wasn't no deception. So even when you get down to the end, when the blessing is getting ready to be passed out to Jacob, the reason I'm telling you this, because it's your forefather. And then people like to say that he was a trickster and he scammed. And that's not true. Even when it got down to the end, when the blessing was getting ready to be passed out to Jacob and Esau, Jacob told his mother, because keep in mind, Rebekah, she knew what the Lord had showed her between the two nations that was in her womb. She knew that the older was going to serve the younger. So by her knowing that when Isaac got old and he getting ready to die, you know, he getting ready to pass the blessing out. So she heard it, and what Rebekah did, she told Jacob, whom she loved, to go cover yourself in all this animal skin, because I guess Esau was hairy. So he put on all this fur and stuff like she told him to, and she put it on him. She dressed him. And he even told his mama. He said, you know, I can't do this in so many words. I'm going to be lying to my father. She said, don't worry about it. Let it be on me. So Jacob wasn't trying to be slick. She knew what the Lord told her, and then at the end of the day, he had to obey his mama. But on top of that, Esau had already sold the birthright. They shouldn't even have to go through all that. So now that we see that Jacob was called supplanter, notice what the Lord is now doing. Go and pick that up again. He changing his name. It ain't Jacob no more, or supplanter no more. Now it's Israel. So now he's getting his name after God. See, that's Jesus' name also, Israel. So you can't beat that. Alright? So keep reading, brother.
That name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel.
Go ahead.
For as a prince hast thou power with God and with man.
That's right. So you got prince. That's what it means, Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with man, and has what?
And has prevailed.
Okay, so I wanted to bring y'all here to let y'all know that, you know, Jacob, his name was changed to Israel. But out of Jacob came the 12 tribes of Israel also, all right? But they still fall up under the name of Jacob. Now let's go on to Jeremiah chapter 30. Jeremiah chapter 30. We're going to pick this up at verse 1. Jeremiah 30 and verse 1. Jeremiah 30 and verse 1. This is another name for this time. This is, we already looked at our temptation, the great tribulation. Now we're going to look at where we get this Jacob's trouble from. You know, and I'm quite sure y'all heard about the mark of the beast. You know, y'all think about it. The mark of the beast ain't really for Israel. You know, it's for buying and selling and all that type of stuff. You know, this ain't really for Jacob, his seed. You know, Jacob ain't got nothing anyway. What are you going to buy and sell? What are you going to trade? You know, this is a time where Jacob's going to be beat down, sister. You know, I do a lot of, I just realized the other day, I have a lot of my customers pay online through PayPal. Well, I don't really like, you know, do a lot of, even when I do get payments, I just do PayPal, I transfer it right into my bank. So the other day, I was talking to this lady, this yard I did the other day, and the lady was like, well, I don't want to use PayPal. So I just wake up in the morning, and she was like, I can just transfer it to your bank. And I'm like, I get an email from Bank of America, and the lady transferred money to my bank. And I was like, wow, man, I just have my customers just go, instead of PayPal, they just transfer right into my bank. You know, if it's like Bank of America, Wells Fargo, or Regions, or whatever, you can just transfer right into the bank account, you know, if you're dealing with different people or whatever. So with the line of work I'm in, you know, people don't be home, and I don't be trying to wait. So just transfer it to my bank or whatever, straight to PayPal. But I'm just thinking about how, like, they're putting all the different, you know, drive-up deposit machines everywhere now. Like, with, I know y'all see the Bank of America things everywhere. We just pull up now, and you can deposit checks in, deposit cash, and you don't even got to go into the bank. Then I can go home. I can just transfer money over. You know what I'm saying? I don't got to go into the bank. But as I was thinking about that, I was thinking about how, like, we slowly getting ready for, like, this cashless society. Like, they're going to start moving that all out the way, and everything going to be done, you know, like, through your whatever mark you're going to have. You're going to have this mark to buy or sell, you know, and it's going to, you know, that's how they're going to keep a track of everything. But they slowly doing away with physical money, you know. And when I saw that the other day, I was just thinking about how, you know, how time is really starting to pick up, and we all starting to get down to this, you know, everything starting to be consumed now. And get us ready for this great tribulation, because they're going to be able to watch everything. They're going to be able to watch the trade, you know, between people. Like back in the day, you know, you can take food stamps, you know, they'd be in a little book. You can take that book and you can give a couple of them food stamps off, and you can go to the store and buy some of the food stamps. But now you can't do that, it's on the card. You see what I'm saying? So now they're getting everything ready, so they're going to be able to track everything. So it's making sense now when I think about what the Bible says, you ain't going to be able to buy or sell, say if he had the mark. So I was wondering to myself, but how they going to know who buying and selling? You know what I'm saying? But now it's starting to make sense. I'm starting to see it now. And they throwing the machines up everywhere now, man. And people don't pay no attention. But as it starts to happen, I just look at it even more like, okay, we getting closer to that time now. We getting closer and closer to the mark of the beast. So, but that's just something I thought about. But it really ain't gonna have nothing to do with Jacob. This time ain't for Jacob. This, in other words, the ones that's gonna be getting purged are the ones that will be the scum of the earth, like the movie Purge. You know, you seen the rich people with the houses, they had the fortresses. I don't know if y'all saw that movie, but they got the house, they had places, they had a fortress off where they can protect themselves. Then you had the outcasts or the ones that nobody wanted, they didn't have no type of protection. Well, that's really how it's gonna be at the end, sister. But Jacob's trouble ain't for Jacob to be prosperous in. Jacob's trouble is for Jacob to catch hell. All right, let's look at Jeremiah chapter 30. Go on, pick it up at verse 1.
The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, thus speaketh the Lord God of Israel, saying, write thee all the words that I have spoken unto thee in a book.
That's right, go ahead.
For lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord.
Go ahead.
And I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it.
Go ahead.
And these are the words that the Lord spake concerning Israel and concerning Judah.
So now check this out now. He said, for lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people, Israel and Judah. Right, in other words, he talking about when he going to set them free from captivity. Right now, they're still in captivity. But he talking about at the end, when he going to set them free, Israel and Judah as a nation. Northern tribes, northern nine tribes were considered Israel. You know, the southern tribe, Judah, Benjamin, and Levi, when Jesus came on the scene, they were considered Judah. All right? So they have been separated. But he's talking about it's going to come a time in the end when he's going to bring Israel and Judah back. Go ahead and read.
For thus saith the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace.
That's right. So notice what he said. He's talking to Jeremiah. He said, but thus saith the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace. Verse 6, and go ahead.
Ask ye now, see whether a man doth travail with child.
Ask ye now, and look around. Think about that. Have you ever seen a man travailing with child? That's the question on the table. He said, ask ye now, see whether a man doth travail with child. Go ahead and read.
Wherefore do I see every man with his hands on his loins as a woman in travail?
So why do I see every man? Because the answer to that is no, we don't see a man travail with child. We see women travailing in pain, you know, to give birth. But notice what he said. He said, well, why do I see every man with his hands on his loins as a woman in travail and all what?
And all faces are turned into paleness.
What's happening? Verse 7.
Alas, for that day is great. So that none is like.
Oh, so ain't no day like this day. This is why this man is travailing. This is why I see that. He said, alas, for that day is great, and there's none like it. And only other time we know that is what? The great tribulation, our temptation. And what else is it called, Brother Cameron?
It is even the time of Jacob's trouble.
Oh, so it's the time of Jacob's trouble, sister, brother. It ain't the time of Ham's trouble. It ain't the time of Japheth's trouble. It's the time of who? Jacob's trouble. That's the same time we looked at in Matthew chapter 24. That's what we also looked at in Revelation chapter 3 concerning our temptation. It's also called the time of Jacob's trouble. Keep reading.
But he shall be saved out of it.
Oh, so the Lord going to save him out of it. But it's going to be bad, but the Lord ain't going to. He still got that covenant with Israel, so he ain't going to completely wipe him out. But he going to allow this stuff to come. This is the time of Jacob's trouble. It's going to last for a time period of 3.5 years. Go ahead and read.
For it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and will burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more serve themselves of him.
That's right. So at the end of this, you know, because we're looking at a long prophecy here. It ain't came to pass yet. But this is what we're getting ready to come into. But he said, well, it's going to come to pass that strangers ain't no more going to serve themselves of him. See, you look at Israel as a nation of people, the world been serving themselves. That's why you got your wig shops owned by Chinese. That's why you're getting your nails done by Vietnamese. That's why you got the Gentiles giving you food. That's why we built America for free. Because the nations have served themselves of us. But it still fall back on us as a nation. But the Lord say, what? It's going to come to pass in that day that the Lord is going to break his yoke from off thy neck. This is after Jacob's trouble occurred. Alright? So that's where we get the name from that. Now let's go a little bit further. Let's go to Revelation chapter 12. Because we got the three names of this event. Jacob's Trouble, the Hour of Temptation, and the Great Tribulation. But now let's go look at the place of safety, sisters and brothers. We're going to find out, you know, because I know we looked at it in Matthew chapter 24 and spoke about those being in Judea fleeing into the mountain. But now we're going to look at it and show that not only are the people that's in Judea got to flee into the mountain, wherever this church is at, first off, wherever the church is at, they still a church today. Israel has always been the church. Now we know from what we saw in Deuteronomy 4, if they disobeyed the Lord, he's going to scatter them in the worldwide captivity. That's what it happened. He's going to scatter them among the heathen. But Israel is still a church. And this church or this woman still got to get to the wilderness at the set time. So look at Revelation chapter 12 and go and pick it up at verse 1.
And there appeared a great wonder in heaven.
Uh-huh.
A woman clothed with the sun.
Go ahead.
And the moon under her feet.
Mm-hmm.
And upon her head a crown of 12 stars.
Uh-huh. So now, read that again from the top.
And there appeared a great wonder in heaven.
Uh-huh.
A woman clothed with the sun. And the moon under her feet.
Uh-huh.
And upon her head a crown of 12 stars.
Okay, so now we got a woman, right? Mm-hmm. Clothed with the sun. And the moon under her feet. And upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Alright, so we're going to go over to Genesis chapter 37. And let's have a look at it. Let's have a look at what this is actually talking about. Because whoever this is, it makes up this woman. Whoever these 12 stars are, it makes up this woman. The sun and the moon make up this woman. So let's just go look at it. We're going to look at Joseph being a dreamer. Joseph's going to dream a dream. Let's see how this dream went down. Genesis chapter 37, go ahead and pick it up at verse 9. Genesis 37, verse 9.
And he dreamed yet another dream.
Mm-hmm. So this Joseph, he dreamed another dream. His brothers didn't like him either because he was his father's favorite son. But he said, yeah, he dreamed another dream. And what else?
And told it his brethren.
Uh-huh.
And said, behold, I have dreamed a dream.
Uh-huh.
More. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me.
Uh-huh. So he said what? He said, behold, the sun and the moon and 11 stars made obeisance to me. Obeisance. So we know we're not, at this point, go ahead and keep reading. We're going to go back to Revelation, but go ahead and keep reading.
And he told it to his father.
Uh-huh.
And to his brethren.
Mm-hmm.
And his father rebuked him.
Uh-huh.
And said unto him,
go ahead.
What is this dream,
uh-huh,
that thou hast dreamed?
Go ahead.
Shall I and thy mother?
So notice what his father said. Now remember he said, remember the dream was what? I dreamed a dream, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me, right? Now his father going to say to him, he said, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I, being the sun, and thy mother, being the moon, and thy brethren, the 11 stars, that's what he's talking about. He said, shall thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? All right, keep reading.
Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come and bow down ourselves to thee?
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
And his brethren envied him.
Uh-huh.
But his father observed the same.
But notice something now. His brothers envied him, but his father observed the same. But his father also interpreted the same. Because see, remember, later on down the line, Joseph was you know, governing Egypt. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
And what had to happen? They had to come down. But see, even at the end, in Revelation 12, this is what make up this woman that we see. So let's go back to Revelation chapter 12. Because they did end up coming down there to Joseph. See, the Lord had already knew that. Matter of fact, he put the friction between them. So much so that they sold him to Ishmael. And then they put him somehow or another he got sold to the Egyptians. He worked for them for a while as a slave. He was, you know, all went through all that. And eventually he came up as governor of Egypt. And then his father, Jacob, then the 12 or the 11 sons had to come down then. Come down in Egypt. And they did make obeisance then. Alright? But now let's go back to Revelation 12, verse 1. Look at that again. So now we'll understand who this woman is. Go ahead, Kiri.
And there appeared a great wonder in heaven.
Uh-huh.
And woman clothed with the sun.
Mm-hmm.
And the moon under her feet.
Go ahead. So now we got this woman clothed with the sun. So the sun being what? Jacob. Mm-hmm. Right? Then it says the moon under his feet being his mother. Keep reading.
And upon her head a crown of the 12 stars.
Now the 12 stars is now all of them, all the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is what makes us that woman, sisters and brothers. Alright? So now let's skip down to verse, let's go back to, I want to bring it back. Let's go to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. Let's go look at these Israelites. Let's see what else they are. Acts chapter 7. This is Stephen giving them a rundown to the Pharisees and they about what happened all the way down from Genesis all the way down to the end. And if you know what was going on right there, they had to pick out some wise men to wait the tables for the Gentiles. But they had 735.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Go ahead and read 735.
This Moses, whom they refused,
uh-huh,
saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge?
Uh-huh.
The same did God send to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel which appeared to him in the bush.
Uh-huh. So we're aware of that. When the, you know, if you're not aware of that, you go back in Exodus, you'll see where he was, where the Lord appeared to Moses in the bush. And he talked to Moses and told him that, you know, go speak to Pharaoh. And he was going to use Moses as the intercessor between God and the people. Also, he's going to use Moses as the deliverer to bring Israel out of Egypt. All right, but go ahead and read.
He brought them out after that he had shewed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And in the Red Sea.
Uh-huh.
And in the wilderness 40 years.
Go ahead.
This is that Moses which said unto the children of Israel.
So notice what he said. This is that Moses that said unto the children of Israel. Go ahead.
A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you,
mm-hmm,
of your brethren. Like unto me, him shall ye hear.
That's right. That's in Deuteronomy chapter 18. Because they were saying that they didn't want God to talk to them no more. So the Lord let them know, we're going to raise up a prophet like unto you of your brethren. You know, him shall ye hear. That was referring to Jesus. But notice what it's saying, verse 38.
This is he.
Uh-huh, so we still talking about Moses. This is he that what?
This is he that was in the church.
That was in the what?
That was in the church.
Oh, that was in the church. Where?
In the wilderness.
Okay, so I just wanted to come and show you here that Israel is the one that came out of captivity. And Israel is the one that make up the church, and Israel is also the one that make up the woman. All right, the reason I want to do that way we'll understand who it is that got to get to the wilderness, who it is that, you know, who makes up this woman, and who it is also that the Lord is speaking to when he's talking about this church that he's going to save during this hour of temptation. It's all pointing back to Israel. All right? So keep, finish that. Is that it on that? Yeah, keep finish that. Okay.
In the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai,
uh-huh,
and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us.
And that's where you got to go to. You got to go back to Mount Sinai. That's where we're going. Matter of fact, somewhere else in here, we might read it, I'm not sure, but it's called the Wilderness of Sinai. So you got the mountain over there, but it's all a big landmass, an area where the Lord going to have us set up at. All right, so now let's go back to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12, and go ahead and pick this up at verse 6. All right, go ahead and read, bro.
And the woman fled into the wilderness.
Uh-huh, so now we still talking about that woman, right? The woman that was made up of what? The sun, the moon, the 12 stars. So we know this woman is Israel now, right? Okay? All right, so it said the woman fled into the wilderness. That what?
Where she have a place prepared of God,
uh-huh,
that they should feed her there 1,260 days.
All right, so this time frame that this woman gonna go into the wilderness, she gonna be fed 1,203 score days. One score is 20. Two scores is 40. Three scores is 60. So actually 1,260 days, 60 days that this woman gonna dwell in the wilderness, or this church, or Israel, gonna dwell in the wilderness. Another time frame for it is 42 months or 3.5 years. That's how long the Great Tribulation gonna be. But during this time, she gonna be in the wilderness. All right, go ahead and keep reading. Skip down to verse 13. No, I'm sorry, keep reading, go ahead.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
So now we jumping all the way back to the beginning, before the world even came into existence, as far as mankind is concerned. Because see, remember when Adam came on the scene, and Eve, you know, she was brought forth, she walking through the garden strolling, and then here comes Satan, come holler at her, right? But you don't read about that in Genesis 1. But here it is in Revelation 12, the Lord is letting us know what happened. That's why he said what? And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And what else?
And the dragon fought and his angels.
So and what? And that dragon, we're going to see who it is. Verse 8.
And prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven.
Okay, so this dragon and his angels fought against Michael and his angels. They did not win. So their place was not found anymore in heaven. That's why Satan wanted to go back to heaven. He wanted to go back to the third heaven where he came from. But he got cast out. And he's not going back. But he got the world thinking that when they die, they're going to heaven. That's how you know the world is being seized by this dragon. But who is he? Verse 9.
And the great dragon was cast out. That old serpent called the devil and Satan.
Oh, so that's who that was in the garden. So we just know that he was an angel. It wasn't no talking snake. Okay? You know, when the Bible referred to him as a snake or a serpent, it just clearly talking about, you know, his characteristics. So he said, the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which do what?
Which deceiveth the whole world.
Some of the world?
Which deceiveth the whole world.
Which deceived the whole world. He was what?
He was cast out into the earth. And his angels were cast out with him.
So we know Satan got cast out to the earth, and he's still on the earth today, right? And his angels were cast out with him. So they still here. So all the evil that you see going on, they work for the Lord. The Lord allows it to happen. Alright? But they dwelling on this earth. You can't see them. I think 2 Peter might be 1 Peter or 2 Peter let you know that they're in chains of darkness. Even Jude let you know they're in chains of darkness. Reserved until the day of judgment. They here, but you just can't see them. Alright, but skip down to verse 13 and go ahead.
And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman, which brought forth the man-child.
All right, read that again real slow. What he did when he got cast out to the earth?
And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth.
So when the dragon saw that he got kicked out of heaven, what did he do?
He persecuted the woman.
Who is the woman, sister and brother?
Israel.
Israel. So this is why all this stuff happening to the children of Israel. It said, when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman, which did what? Which brought forth the man-child. Keep reading, verse 14.
And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time.
That's 1 year. Keep reading.
And time. And half a time.
That's right, so 1 year plus time, which is 2 years, that's a total of 3.5. A time is 3.5 years from what?
From the face of the serpent.
Okay, so notice what it says. Now we all the way down to the, we jumping down to the end, to the great tribulation now. And it says, until the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness. No, she not going to fly into the wilderness as far as, you know, we going to get wings on our back as a church. No, we just talking about up under the protection of the Lord. So he said, until the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, but we also talking about this angel that the Lord going to have, you know, with this church, which we're going to read, because the Lord ain't going to do nothing different. So until the woman given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness. Because in the wilderness, this is where you got to be during the time of the great tribulation, sister and brother. If you make it to the wilderness, there's a high chance of you taking on everlasting life. A very high chance. As opposed to you not getting into the wilderness, put it this way. We over here in America, we haven't been raised up around people getting beheaded. We haven't been raised up around our kids starving and stuff like that. So I'm going to just tell you like this. The chances are real low if you get caught in this great tribulation. That's what I would advise you, you know, just to try your best to pay attention to what's going on and get to the wilderness. If it wasn't important, the Lord wouldn't have it in the Bible. So he said, to the woman, give her two great wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness, and she's going to be there for 3.5 years, not 7 years, because the great tribulation lasts 3.5 years. All right, keep reading, brother.
Mm-hmm. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman.
Uh-huh, because when this woman is running, see, remember now, we got to flee. So as we fleeing or we running to the wilderness, what's going to happen here? The serpent going to cast out of his mouth water as a flood. We're talking about an army system, brother. That's what's coming. Just like, you know, just like back in the day, what happened with Pharaoh and the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. You had them armies coming after them, and what happened? The earth opened up, the Red Sea opened wide open, right? And it swallowed up those armies. Well, the same thing going to happen. Satan going to send a flood, or he's going to send his military to chase us down. The Lord said what? The earth going to open up her mouth. So the Lord going to do the same thing, but this time he may be with an earthquake or something. He said, earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth. Verse 17.
And the dragon was wroth with the woman.
Uh-huh, the dragon was mad at the woman. Go ahead.
And went to make war with the remnant of her seed.
Uh-huh, so now he's coming back to make war with the ones that remained here, that didn't get to the wilderness. Go ahead, keep reading.
Which keep the commandments of God.
Oh, so that's what it's all about. He come back to get the ones that keep the commandments of God, not the ones, you know, that do what they want to do. The ones that keep the Sabbath day, the ones that keep the dietary law, the ones that keep the Ten Commandments. This is who he coming to. Because they're going to be putting a dent in his game. Which keep the commandments of God and have what?
And have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
All right, so now let's go to Exodus chapter 19. Because, you know, we just saw that, what, the woman was given two wings of a great eagle to get into the wilderness. Well, we're just going to show you that it ain't going to be nothing different than what it was last time. It's going to be the same exact thing. It's going to be the same exact thing. It ain't going to be nothing different. See, we hear about it, we read about how the Lord did things back in that time. But just so you know, we're alive to see this. We blessed also to be able to witness this great event that's getting ready to come on the earth. You know, but at the same time, it's a catch to it, put it that way. We got to make it all the way down to this time, in other words. All right, so Exodus chapter 19, go and pick it up at verse 1.
In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt,
uh-huh.
The same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai.
Uh-huh, see that right there? They came into the wilderness of Sinai. That's where we're going at. Back out to the wilderness of Sinai. All right, keep reading.
For they were departed from
Rephidim. Uh-huh.
And were come to the desert of Sinai,
mm-hmm.
And had pitched in the wilderness.
Go ahead.
And there Israel camped before the mount.
Uh-huh, right before the mount, because that's where the Lord came down. But you got to realize, you know, you got over 600,000 people out there. That's just men of, Israel and not including other nations. So you got a lot of people out there, sister and brother. So you know it got to be a big area. Mm-hmm. So this is how it's going to be in the end in our time. Going to the same place, it's going to be a big area. But we're going to see what's going to happen to the area. Because right now the area is still dormant. You know, and the Lord going to have it blocked off where they ain't going to be able to touch that area. But he says what? And they had pitched in the wilderness, and there is what camped before the mount, verse 3.
And Moses went up unto God.
Uh-huh.
And the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob,
mm-hmm.
And tell the children of Israel,
go ahead.
Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bear you on the eagle's wings.
Oh, notice what he said. He said, you've seen what I did to the Egyptians. And how I did what? How I bear you on the eagle's wings. But we can't read nowhere in the Bible where Israel actually flew out of there. You know, we read the event that took place with Israel. They walked through the Red Sea, right? But see, they had the protection of the angel. That's how it's going to be in the end. That's what we're talking about when he say, you know, until the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness. We're just going to be under the protection of that eagle. Just like, or that angel, just like it was back in the old days. Now go ahead and keep reading. Mm-hmm. That's it on that?
No. And brought you into myself.
Uh-huh. All right, now, let's go. Brought you into myself. I'm going to do that. Let's go to Psalm chapter 91.
Okay.
Psalm chapter 91. When you get to verse 1, you can go ahead and read it, though.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
Also, notice what it says. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High. People like to say that right now. Like you got some secret closet in your room. Or you got a secret place at your house. Now, we talking about the secret place of the Most High. The reason why it's called the secret place of the Most High, because don't nobody or the world does not understand that this particular place or the wilderness of Sinai is what the Lord going to use to hide his church. This is why it's called the secret place of the Most High. That's why I say he that dwell in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 2.
I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God.
Go ahead.
In him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence.
That's right, because this, you know, we talking about during a particular time when the world is getting ready to go up under this destruction that's coming. And during this time, notice what it says, he's going to deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. And he's going to do what? Verse 4.
He shall cover thee with the feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust.
That's right, and it's that angel that's going to be protecting. It's that angel that's going to be guiding us and watching us as we head out of here to get to the wilderness. And once you get to the wilderness, you're going to be protected. You're going to see all types of stuff going on around you, but guess what? It ain't going to touch you. Why? Because you're up under the protection of the Almighty God. But what did he say?
His truth shall be thy shield.
What's going to be your shield?
His truth
shall be. His truth going to be your shield. And what else?
And
buckler. And one thing you look at right now, you know, the way we know about this, the way we find out about this, because we came into the Word of God. And ultimately, at the end of the day, this is what's going to save us. The truth is what's going to keep us. And the truth is what's going to allow us to make the decisions, you know, to get out of this time frame. But verse 5, go ahead.
Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by the
day. That's right. We just talking about war material. He said, you ain't got to worry about that. You ain't got to be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the air that fly by day, because you done made it to the place of safety. You done got to the secret place. See, that's the whole goal. You know, we keep the Sabbath day, we keep the commandments, we fellowship. Don't drop the ball at the end. Don't do all this for nothing. Then you drop the ball, you don't make it out, then you mess around and turn back. Because don't say you got it. You know, try going without eating a couple days. And that'll let you know where your faith at. But I sure dropped the ball after 2 days. I thought I was about to die. I mean, seriously. Some people can do 4 and 5 days, and 6 and 7 and 9 and 10. Y'all can have it. I can't do it. You know what I'm saying? And you know how the church fasts once a month? I'm glad it's voluntary. Put it that way. You know? But keep reading, brother.
Nor for the pestilence that walketh in the darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday.
That's right, because all type of destruction going to be going on at this time. But you ain't got to worry about it, because you're in the secret place. He said, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. What's going to happen? Verse 7.
1,000 shall fall at thy side.
We talking about people dying. He said, 1,000 going to fall at your side, and what else?
10,000 at thy right hand.
You going to see it. You're going to see it in high definition. He said, 1,000 going to fall at your side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but what?
But it shall not come nigh thee.
Why? Because you're in the place of safety. You are not dwelling in the secret place. See, this is why it's important for you to get ready, because you're going to have to run. You're going to have to leave everything behind. So it says, verse 8.
Only with thine eyes shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked.
See, I told you you're going to see it. He said, with your eyes you're going to behold and see the reward of the wicked. Keep reading.
Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
That's right. Go ahead. Verse 10.
There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling.
That's right. Now, we're not talking about nigh today. You know, he says, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. We're not talking about right now. You know, I remember back in the day, matter of fact, they used to have a song that kind of went something like, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. But we ain't talking about right now. You know, because you take a gun and put it on somebody and shoot them, it's going to prosper. You know, we talking about a particular time frame with what the Lord is talking about. So it says, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come out thy dwelling. For what? Verse 11.
For he shall give his angels charge over thee.
Oh, because remember he said he's going to cover you with his wings. He said, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to do what?
To keep thee in all thy ways.
Oh, okay, so that's what's going to protect us. That's what's going to keep us at this time. And I'm beginning to wonder if he's going to be Gabriel, because he also said that truth is going to be that shield and that buckler too. So, you know, I look a little further than that. But let's go into Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah 35, let me get a good one, pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead, bro.
The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them.
Uh-huh, see what it say? It say the wilderness and the solitary place is going to be glad for them. Go ahead and read.
And the desert shall rejoice.
Uh-huh, the desert going to rejoice. Why? Because the church coming back. The church getting ready to head on back to the wilderness now. So I say the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. And what else?
And blossom as the rose.
The desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. Go ahead and read.
It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing.
Uh-huh.
The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto them.
That's right. Go ahead.
The excellency of Carmel and Sharon.
Sharon.
Uh-huh. They shall see the glory of the Lord,
mm-hmm,
and the excellency of our God.
That's right. Go ahead. Because see, you know, the Lord going to be protecting this church at this time. But go ahead and read verse 3.
Strengthen ye the weak hands, mm-hmm, and confirm the feeble knees.
That's right. Go ahead. Because at this time, you know, a lot of you going to, you know, taking this run or trying to get to the wood, it's going to be hard. It ain't going to be no easy walk, sister, bro. I'm talking about you got, we, listen, we got to get across that water. And that water is a long way. So I, you know, we're going to look in here and we just hope. I don't know how you're going to do it. We're going to look at, you know, some possible examples of how we may get over there. But my point is, it ain't going to be easy. It's not going to be easy, sister, bro. So that's why I say, strengthen ye the weak hands and confirm the knee with, feeble knees and what else?
Say to them that are a fearful heart,
uh-huh,
be strong.
Go ahead.
Fear not.
Because once you get there, you ain't got a word no more. But you fear for all that time. That whole time you running trying to escape, you scared. Because this ain't nothing like we ever seen before. But it say, be strong, fear not what?
Behold, your God will come with vengeance.
Uh-huh.
Even God with a recompense.
That's right, go ahead.
He will come and save you.
Mm-hmm.
Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened.
That's right, so when you get there, we ain't got to worry about the sickness going on, the ailments going on. The Lord going to bring forth healing that day. He said, what? The eyes of the blind shall be opened. What else?
And the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped.
Uh-huh.
Then shall the lame man leap as in heart,
mm-hmm,
and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out,
uh-huh,
and streams in the desert.
That's right. So the wilderness is going to come back to life, sister, brother. Why? Because the church coming back. But right now, it's dormant. Right? This is why it's called a secret place. Ain't nobody really paying no attention, but even when it starts blossoming, when it starts coming back, we'll know what to look for. We'll know, okay, yeah, it's getting ready for us. It's starting to come back to life now. Because the Lord getting prepared for the church. That's why you got to worry about taking nothing. You ain't got to worry about your paycheck and all that type of stuff. Worry about what you're going to eat when you get there, your clothes and all that. The Lord got this thing already sorted. This ain't some hood, you know, some hood type of getaway. You know, we ain't got to make no appointment and all that type of stuff and save up our money to get there. The Lord got everything. You know how when you go on vacation, you got a certain amount of money allotted for you to spend? We ain't going to go down like this. The Lord going to already have everything taken care of when you get there. So he said, a parched ground shall become a pool, and what else?
And a thirsty land, springs of water,
uh-huh,
and the habitation of dragons.
Go ahead.
Where each lake shall be grass with reeds and rushes.
Uh-huh. And that's what's going to happen. Now, notice what he say. He said, a parched ground, we're talking about a dry ground, it's going to become a pool, and a thirsty land, springs of water, and the habitation of dragons. This is where animals are, you know, whatever dragons is in this case. Not Satan. We just talking about a particular type of animal that live out there. What'd you say, lizards and snake? Possibly. Yeah, that sounds more reasonable. He said the habitation of dragons, where each lay shall be grass with reeds and rushes. So all this stuff gonna come back to life. You know nothing don't really grow in the desert besides cactuses. You know, but at this time, stuff gonna start coming back to life. Verse 8, and go ahead.
And an highway shall be there.
Uh-huh.
And a way. And it shall be called the way of holiness.
Uh-huh.
The unclean shall not pass over.
Oh, that's how, that's just how you're gonna get in there. You got to be holy, sister, brother. Guess what? You gotta keep them commandments. That's how you're gonna get there. He said, a highway shall be there, and a way it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over, but go ahead.
But it shall be for those,
uh-huh,
the wayfaring men.
Y'all know what wayfaring mean? That means man walking on foot. Or traveling by foot. That's who it's for. That's who this wilderness is for. Keep reading.
Thou fool shall not err therein.
Uh-huh.
No lion shall be there.
Yeah, this ain't in it, but keep reading though. Keep reading. It said, no lion shall be there, uh-huh.
Nor any raven.
Ravenous beast
shall go up therein.
Uh-huh.
It shall not be found there.
Mm-hmm.
But the redeemed shall walk there.
That's right. Go ahead. The redeemed gonna be there. Verse 10, go ahead.
And the ransom of the Lord shall return,
uh-huh,
and come to Zion with psalms and everlasting joy upon their heads.
Uh-huh. And that's ultimately what's going to happen at the end. He said, the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads, and they shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Keep reading Micah chapter 7. And then let's look over to Micah chapter 7.
Okay.
And I think we're going to stop around Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 8. Because next week, Jediah is going to do the two wildernesses. And I think that'll, you know, when we stop right here, that'll give, let him kind of go over, you know, the in-depth part of the tribulation. You know what I'm saying? But this should be enough. Like I said, I want to really focus on us getting out of there. You know, looking at the time, our temptation, the great tribulation, Jacob's trouble, who it pertains to, and also our way out of this thing. Because like I say, we really don't spend too much time on getting out of here, what it's going to be like when we get there, that type of stuff. So I want to look at that today. So Micah chapter 7. Micah chapter 7. And go and pick this up at verse 14. But I got to get there, right? All right, Micah chapter 7 and verse 14. All right, go ahead and read, bro.
Feed thy people with the rod, the flock of thine heritage.
Uh-huh. So notice what it says. Feed thy people. We're talking about Israel in the church at this time. It says, feed thy people with thy rod, the flock of thine heritage, which do what?
Which dwell solitarily.
Uh-huh.
In the wood.
Oh, so what was dwell solitarily in the wood? We're talking about the ones that dwell in the wood. They're going to be taken care of. Which dwell solitary in the wood in the midst of what?
In the midst of Carmel.
Mm-hmm.
Let them feed in Bashan.
Uh-huh.
In Gilead, as in the days of old.
So you ain't got to worry about what you're going to cook. You ain't got to worry about bringing food and all that. The Lord's going to take care of all that. We're going to be straight. We just got to get there. We got to get there, you know. And you know you're going to have a lot of people in your ear. Where y'all going? What y'all think y'all doing? Oh, y'all doing that Jim Jones thing. You know, but see, you can't read none of what they did in the Bible. I mean, as far as, you know, them fleeing to the wilderness, you can read false prophets going to deceive them, and that's what happened to them. But as far as us, we going to be able to, we can look into the Bible and see, you know, matter of fact, let me just explain something. When you see, you happen to be alive, and you see the armies, and you see them start building the temple and all that type of stuff, because right now there's no temple, right? Right now, there's no sacrifice going on, right? We're telling y'all that, right? Because we're reading it out of the Bible. If it starts happening, if you ain't convinced by then you're going to get caught. You know, but just enough should be Deuteronomy 28, verse 60. Where he said, I'm going to send you into Egypt again with ships, and then you're going to be sold to your enemies, bomb in a bomb with you. Listen, I woke up in the Word of God, and I was already scattered on ships. Before I even came on this earth, you know, before I was even born, the Lord had already told us this was going to happen. You know, so it don't really take no more convincing for me. So when we see this start happening, you know, your faith, if you ain't got your faith up at that point, then you might not be fit for the wilderness. All right, so Micah chapter 7, he said, well, feed thy people with thy rod, the flock of thine heritage, which dwell solitarily and the wood in the midst of Carmel, let them feed of Bashan and Gilead as in the days of old, according to what? Verse 15.
According to the days of thy coming out of the land of Egypt, will I shew unto him marvelous things.
Oh, so he said what? According to the days of thy coming out of the land of Egypt, I'm going to show unto you marvelous things. Just like he did it then, but he tell you somewhere else. I can't remember where it's at. Look that up from the Demonio, young man. He said, behold, I'm going to do a new thing. I'll do a new thing. He's going to open up rivers. Somebody can Google that. He said, I'm going to do a new thing. Yeah, I want to read that. I ain't put it in here. I didn't think I was going to need it. But I want to read that. I want to show y'all that. Because he's making reference to the wilderness of old, but he's going to do it again.
I'm going to do a new thing in the Bible.
I think I got a mark in here.
Isaiah 43:19.
Yeah, let's just go look at that right quick, guys. We can look at it. Because see, the Micah say, he said, verse 15, according to the days of thy coming out of the land of Egypt, will I show unto him marvelous things. So you go back and you see what happened with the children of Israel, how he took care of them. Their shoes ain't get old walking in the wilderness for 40 years, man. The Lord took care of Israel. Well, he gonna let us know he gonna do a new thing. He gonna take care of Israel again. Isaiah chapter 43, pick it up at verse 18.
Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old.
Go ahead.
Behold, I will do a new thing.
Oh, so he say, don't consider the things of old, even though it's going to be like that, but don't, just have that as a measuring point, just to know that he's going to do it again. He said, remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. What are he going to do?
Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know
it? Behold, I'll do a new thing, now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I'll do what? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So we talking about something that's going to take place all the way at the end in our time, sisters and brothers. But we see it took place in Egypt. You know, we just read that in Micah. But no, if you notice what he said in verse 18, he said, remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old, because he's going to do it completely over again. And this is what, you know, we looking forward to at our time. But I wanted to show y'all that. Let's go a little further. Let's go over to Isaiah chapter 16. Isaiah chapter 16. See, this is what need to be being preached to the church. This is what the word that people need to be getting fed, man. You know, as teachers, us. Even the church here, when you leave out of here, you a teacher. You gotta let people know about the word of God. You know, it's a witness by your life. Because people watching you, whether you say anything or not, people watching how you live. They looking at you to see if you're gonna drop the ball. You know, I remember my father used to call me around Mother's Day and just try to check me just to see if I was gonna, fall. Say things like, let me talk to your wife and tell her happy Mother's Day. And I said, Dad, we won't celebrate that. He said, well, let me just tell her happy day. I said, that don't make sense. But it's just straight disrespect. But what I'm just saying, people just, they looking at you to see if you're going to fall. But as a church, this is what you got to teach them. You got to teach them how to serve God. And at the same time, teach them how to save themselves. The whole world should be getting messages, getting lessons, being taught how to save themselves. But they're not getting that, sister brother. But the Lord has blessed us. You know, the Lord is blessing us that we can do what we have to do to try to save ourselves. Isaiah chapter 16, go and pick it up at verse 1.
Send ye the lamb to the ruler of the land from Selah to the wilderness.
Go ahead. So notice who the lamb is. Now, the lamb is Jesus. So you're learning something on the way to learning something. When Jesus gets back, where is he going? Read that from the top again.
Send ye the lamb to the ruler of the land from Selah to the wilderness.
So the Lord, when he gets back, he going to the wilderness. I just want you to know that. Jesus ain't coming back and going straight to Jerusalem. He going to the wilderness. And in Ezekiel chapter 20, let you know he going to deal with the people like he dealt with our forefathers back then. Hopefully, it ain't us. Hopefully, we done took on immortality. So he said, send ye the lamb to the ruler of the land from Selah to the wilderness, unto the mount of the daughter of Zion. Verse 2.
For it shall be that as the wandering bird cast out of the nest, so the daughters of Moab shall be at the fords of Arnon.
So he said, this is where the daughters of Moab shall be at the fords of Arnon. Now, this is the location where Moab is located. But verse 3, and go ahead.
Take counsel. Execute judgment. Make thy shadow as the night in the midst of the noonday.
So he say, take counsel, execute judgment, make thy shadow as the night in the midst of the noonday. So in other words, it's gonna be clear day outside, but the Lord gonna have us protected where can't nobody see us, can't nobody get to us. But he letting you know the location where it's gonna be at. All right, well go ahead and keep reading.
Hide the outcast.
Hide what?
Hide the outcast.
And that's what Israel is today, an outcast. He said, hide the outcast to do what?
Raid not him that wanders.
That's right, because guess what? We're going to be wandering, sisters and brothers. You know, we're because we're wondering where we going at. We just going. So what did he say? He said, don't berate him that wanders. Verse 4, keep reading.
Let mine outcast dwell with thee.
He said, let my outcast dwell with thee. Go ahead.
Moab. Be thou a covert to them from the face of the spoiler.
That's right. Be a covert to them from the face of the spoiler. The spoiler, we talking about this abomination of desolation, or the son of perdition, the one that's going to have power to bring down this world. He's going to get his power from Satan. He's going to be the one that have power to destroy man. Not all the man, but man. So he said, hide them from the face of the spoiler. Go ahead and read.
For the extortioner is at the end. The spoiler ceaseth. The oppressors are consumed out of the land. And in mercy shall the throne be established, and he shall sit upon it in truth in the tabernacle of David.
All right, so that's good right there. I wanted verse 4. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 23. We got one more place after this, I believe. Yeah, y'all can look at those other... those other scriptures on your own. You know, this morning I knew I was getting carried away. I really don't do like past 22 scriptures. I done got 28. But it's just so much pertaining to this subject. And I was just like, you know what, that's enough. So as I'm actually reading it now, yeah, that's enough. We don't need to, you know, talk about that in Bible study. Y'all can read it at home on your own time. A couple months ago, I had just did one. Pertaining to the Gentile dynasty anyway, so it ain't necessary right now. So Isaiah chapter 23, and verse 17, go ahead.
And it shall come to pass after the end of 70 years, that the Lord will visit Tyre, and she shall turn to her hire.
Now check this out now, I just want y'all to understand something. In Jeremiah, the Lord told Israel, they was going to go into captivity for 70 years, right? Now, we're not talking about 70 literal years. We're talking about 70 prophetic years. So 70 times 70 would actually be 490 prophetic years. All right? When Jesus came and stopped. He stopped it at the end. In other words, when Jesus came and died, it ended at 486 and a half years, right? So all the way down to the end. Put it this way, the 490 years or the 70 years that we're talking about right here is not going to be complete until the end, all the way at the end. All right, it's not right now. It says it shall come to pass after the end of 70 years. Because in Jeremiah 25, it was prophesied that Israel was going into captivity for 70 years. All right, the 70 years or the prophetic years, 490 years, does not end until Jesus gets back, right? So we coming here to show you that when Jesus get back, he going to have the church, well not the church, because we going to the wilderness before Jesus get back. He going to have the nation of Israel. Because when you look at Israel, you got two Israels. First you got the church, Israel the church. Right? Because like we made up of the church. The church is made up of all nations. And everybody come up on the commonwealth of Israel, they become Israel. Then you got physical Israel. Alright? These are the ones that's going to be gathered as a nation when Jesus get back. This when he get back, he's going to gather them from all, they're going to be scattered. Now, we got scattered throughout the whole world. When Jesus get back, he's going to gather us from all nations and put us back in the land. if we didn't take on their mortality. Alright? This is who he's talking about right here. The ones that he's going to gather and take them to the wilderness. So I'm giving you an example of how he's going to take care of them. And if we the church, he got to take care of us if we happen to get to the wilderness first. So he says it's going to come to pass after the end of 70 years that the Lord will visit Tyre. This is the Gentile nation. And notice what she's going to do. Keep reading.
And she shall turn to her hire.
Uh-huh.
And she'll commit fornication.
So she's going to turn to her hire and commit fornication. She's not going to commit fornication as far as sexually is concerned. We talking about fornication where she going, you know, actually start making deals with the nations. Go ahead and keep reading.
Commit fornication with all the kingdoms of the world upon the face of the earth.
That's right. Go ahead.
And her merchandise and her hire shall be holiness to the Lord.
So her merchandise and her hire, her work, going to be holy to the Lord. Keep reading.
It shall not be treasured nor laid up.
That's right, because they ain't going to take it. They ain't going to make money and get rich and save it and store it up, you know, and try to pass it down to their children's children. No, it says it shall not be treasured nor laid up for what?
For her merchandise shall be for them.
So her merchandise is going to be for them. Who? Israel. Keep reading.
That dwell before the Lord.
Uh-huh, that dwell before the Lord, uh-huh.
To eat sufficiently.
To eat sufficiently. What else they going to have?
And for durable clothing.
Oh, so this is why when you run it, you ain't got to worry about taking them. That's why he said when you come down off the roof, don't go back to get anything. Don't go ahead trying to get your clothes and all that type of stuff. He says what? He says it's going to be for them. Holiness to the Lord, it shall not be treasured nor laid up for a merchandise shall be for them that dwell before the Lord to eat sufficiently. So this is what Tyre going to do. She going to go into what? Committing abominations and whoredom and stuff like that to get food and stuff for Israel in the wilderness. To eat sufficiently and for durable clothing. Right. So I just want to make sure y'all understand what I just said, all right? First Israel, you got to come up under the commonwealth of Israel, right? You can be a physical Israelite all day long. That don't matter at the end of the day if you ain't serving God. So the church is what's going to get to the wilderness first. Israel, the church is going to get to the wilderness first. And then you still going to have physical Israelites that didn't make it, you know, that's still sitting here, still want to serve the master, don't want to leave America and all that type of stuff. But when the Lord get back, the Israel, the nation of people, that's who he's going to gather to the wilderness. And they're going to have to pass up under the covenant, under the bond of the covenant. They're going to do it like he said, I'm going to purge out the rebels. So the ones that don't want to keep his commandments, he's going to kill them. But if we make up the church right now, if we doing what we're supposed to do, we'll take on everlasting life when Jesus is back. We ain't got to worry about death no more. See, that's the whole reason you want to serve the Lord, and then hopefully the Lord will save us and get us out of here. Because like I say, the chances go down of you being saved once that great tribulation jump off. So now let's go to Isaiah chapter 60 and pick it up at verse 8. And it's another place where we talk about when the Lord get back to this earth, and we're looking at means of transportation. When Jesus get back to this earth, the Lord going to have Israel gathered up to him. And they're going to come from all over the world. But we're looking at how they're going to get there. So the Lord going to make a way for them to get there. He got to make a way for us to get there. But just in case you're thinking to yourself, well, how is it going to happen? You know, how is it going to happen? Well, just let me just explain something to you. Just like they're going to have transportation to get back over there, we got to have a way to get back over there, too. And we're going to have to get it done in 30 days. So Isaiah chapter 6, we're going to pick it up at verse 8. Notice what Isaiah is seeing during this time. Isaiah 6 and verse 8, what does it say, brother?
Who are these that fly as a cloud?
Uh-huh.
And as the doves to their windows.
So notice the description that Isaiah is giving. See, this is talking about Israel being delivered. Are coming back where the Lord is saying that he's going to bring them back. They're going to come up in droves from all over the world. Notice what the scripture says. It says, who are these that fly as a cloud? Because we're talking about means of transportation at this point. And these means of transportation were talked about way back in the day. Now we can understand. But he said, who are these that fly as a cloud? What fly as a cloud, sister and brother? And that's dove to their windows. Well, nobody ain't talking about doves. The birds don't got no windows. We ain't talking about, say it again?
Airplanes.
What you mean, Delta? He said, who are these that fly as a cloud and has dove to their windows? And what's another means of transportation? Verse 9.
Surely the isles shall wait for me.
Surely the isles shall wait for me. The isles going to wait for me. And what else?
And the ships of Tarshish.
And the ships of Tarshish. We talking about ships now. Tarshish is a Gentile. He gonna go back into business just like his kinfolk Tyree. She gonna go in the Hornets and Abomination to get the clothes and all that type of stuff. He gonna go into business, you know, back into his particular trade. That's why I think when you look at Carnival Cruise Line and all the one that started with an R, I can't remember. But what is it called? Royal Caribbean. Look at all the different cruise ships and stuff like that. Yeah, it got to go back to Tarshish then. Because, you know, even at the end, notice what it's saying. The isle's going to wait for me and the ships of Tarshish. We see a lot of big old cruise ships around the world. But guess what? That's your means of transportation to get back home. So he's saying the ships of Tarshish first to bring thy sons from where? From far. Because they've been scattered all over the world, sisters and brothers. Keep reading.
Their silver and their gold with them.
Uh-huh, because you're going to come right back to the land just like Egypt. Just like Israel did when they spoiled the Egyptians. They came out with gold and silver. That's how it's going to be. Because everybody's going to be like, oh, y'all the people of the Bible? Yeah, y'all had this nigga. See, everybody want to be cool to you then. When your big brother show up. You know, everybody want to change the attitude then. Well, that's how it's going to be when the Lord come on back. He says, they're going to bring our sons and father their silver and their gold with them unto what?
Unto the name of the Lord thy God.
Uh-huh.
And to the Holy One of Israel, mm-hmm. because he hath glorified thee.
That's right. So they're going to bring up Israel to the Lord. And this is how they're going to get there. This is how the means of transportation going to be at this time. So the Lord going to make a way for them to get there. You know he got to make a way for us. So that's the lesson, the great tribulation, the hour of temptation, Jacob's trouble. It's all bad. I hope you guys understand in Jesus' name. But you'll never find